CBS. Welcome home.
Today, the Jiffy Lube Miami 300 will be run before a sold-out crowd of over 60,000 people here in Florida and millions of viewers on TV, thanks to the support of NASCAR fans, Jiffy Lube employees, and franchisees. Jiffy Lube is proud to be the sponsor of what we call the greatest race under the sun.
Southern Florida, it's steady pulse, calm, and the gentle breezes. A place where the warm, seductive rhythms of the sun are enjoyed. Last year, a new attraction blossomed in the Sunshine State, the Metro-Dade Homestead Motorsports Complex. The impact on the racing world and its fans immediate. With two laps to go, the leaders tangled, and it was Dale Jarrett, hailed as the inaugural champion. Today, New England's Randy Lajoie awaits to be crowned the overall points leader in the final race of 96, looking for one final kiss to cap off a career year. But waiting patiently behind is Kentucky's David Green, who's had a terrific season of his own. One more race, one more run for glory. Welcome to a NASCAR Day of Champions, a championship doubleheader here at Homestead, Florida. It's the Grand National Championship, and later in Las Vegas, the Truck Series to be decided. Race one, the Jiffy Lube 300, drawn 65,000 to Homestead. 43 drivers go for the win, two scrap for the national title. Randy Lajoie leads by 33 points. Six or better is going to give him the title over the 1994 champion, David Green. Ned Jarrett walked this morning with the principals in this championship war.
Well, gentlemen, this is it. Just a couple of hours away. Randy, did you get any sleep last night?
Oh, it's not a problem. I usually get a good night's sleep anytime.
How are you going to approach this race?
Pretty much like any of them. If I have a good race car, I'm going to try to get it to the front. But I think the way this racetrack is today and the way it's been all week, we need to be there at the end. So I'm not going to take any unnecessary chances.
David, you get a good night's rest and ready for this thing?
I didn't sleep at all, Ned. And it wasn't because I was worried. I'm pretty excited. You know, I think all weekend long, Randy and I have been dealt some pretty tough cards here with the racetrack. But we've both come out of it pretty good, and we're ready to race. And, you know, it doesn't do any good to worry about it, but I feel pretty good. The CAT team's done a great job. But, you know, we just got to, like Randy said, we got to stay in there and be around and fight it out those last 50 laps.
Well, now to beat this guy over here, of course, you're the one that's down in the points. So really, what do you got to do?
Same old thing. Like Randy said, again, we have got to stick to our game plan, and that's finish all 300 miles, 200 laps there, and keep all the fenders on it, which is going to be an issue today, you know, and be there at the very end. But same old thing. We can't differ from what we've done all year long, and trying not to let this last race championship deal get wrapped up into it, because it's the same old deal. But I feel comfortable with what we got to do and what we're going to have to do.
Okay, good luck to both of you.
Metro-Dade Homestead Motorsports Complex. It has the feel and the flavor of the tropics. Florida itself. It is the vision of impresario Ralph Sanchez, who spent nearly $70 million on this facility. Hello, Ken Squire with Ned Jarrett, and we're here in the chalet area. $17 million, and it's a beauty right here alone. In fact, the whole facility's a beauty. But the mile-and-a-half track, Ned, it's a beast.
Yes, it is. Yesterday, in one of the qualifying races, Mike Laughlin had a hard crash coming off of Turn 4. His car caught fire. Devastating accident.
In fact, he's in the hospital today, but the reports are pretty good for him. He has some burns on his hands and neck, but he's coming along fine.
This is a four-corner racetrack, a quad oval, with very little banking in the turns, only 8 degrees of banking. Last year, it was a single-groove racetrack. hard for the drivers to pass on. So they went in and put 12 feet of asphalt down on the inside to hopefully promote side-by-side racings going into and out of the turns. But it hasn't quite worked that way, because if they go in there side-by-side at the speeds that they're running now, faster than last year, they can get into the wall in a hurry.
Side-by-side racing can be devastating here. Take a look at the final moments of 1995. Larry Pearson fighting with Hermie Sadler and Kenny Wallace, going down into turn 350 miles an hour. And goodbye to the top three competitors. Dale Jarrett sailed home the winner. Earlier this morning, Larry McReynolds was out at turn three with Kenny Wallace.
Kenny, we're standing here in turn three at Homestead. A lot of memories for you here. You was coming to take the white flag last year, and all of a sudden three of you pile up here in turn three. Why is this corner in particular at Homestead so tough and so treacherous to get through?
Well, Larry, we're carrying such high speeds down this back straightaway. Beautiful facilities, running 160 mile an hour. The problem we got is we got to make such a hard left-hand corner. Track wants to simulate Indianapolis Motor Speedway, but the problem is that we need it to be a little bit more of an oval getting in. As you see where this yellow paint is, this is where the car wants to run. The car wants to go down into here. So, you know, basically, this is one of our biggest problems. We're wanting to run into this yellow paint, and then when we get into the corner, we want to make a hard left. So we need a little bit better of an entrance. We need a gradual entrance. So you see where the black is, that's where we're running.
Well, has the 12 feet that they've added, has it helped, or has it made any difference at all?
Well, it's helped a little bit, but it's not in the right area. You know, that's the biggest problem. I mean, it's a beautiful racetrack, and I don't want to condemn it in any way, but this is where it needed to be brought down. Where they brought it down, you know, anytime they make a racetrack wider, we're going to use it up. It's just that the corners are too tight. We can't run. The radius is too much at the top and not enough at the bottom. So, really, you know, the biggest problem is if you come in this corner side by side, it's like making a left-hand turn on Main Street in your hometown. When you're by yourself, it's okay, but when two people go side by side, it's a lot like Darlington coming off of four. It's virtually impossible to make, and the guy behind you is gonna pass both of you.
No track that is more respected or more feared in only its second year than Homestead. The man that everyone is talking about for this race as far as winning overall has raced only 13 times in 25 races to date this year. But he's won half of them. Arkansas's Mark Martin is with Dick Berggren.
And Ken, of those 13 races, Mark Martin has led every single one. Four of the six wins have come in this very car he has here. This guy is so tough, several of the drivers say to finish second to him, why, that's every bit as good as a win. But Mark, how about today? How are you going to run it?
Well, I don't know, not a lot different than any other race. I think safety is critical today, or crucial, but in order to finish first, you know, you have to finish, so it's kind of the same as always. You have to be real careful out here today.
Working with me on pit road today is Ralph Shaheen. Ralph?
All right, I'm going to... Audio difficulty in getting down to Ralph Shaheen, who was there with the pole sitter, Bobby Labonte. Let's go down for a moment to get this one going. The mayor of Metro Dade County, Alex Pinellas, is standing by. Give the command.
In the season championship, we ask that you please now direct your attention to the start-finish line. I would like to introduce the newly elected Metro Dade County Mayor, Alex Pinellas, who will now give us the command to start the second annual Jiffy Lube Miami 300.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to beautiful Dade County and the city of Homestead. And now for the moment you have all been waiting for, gentlemen, start your engines.
Down here in Miami, 43 cars ready to participate. Stand by, we'll give you a starting lineup in a moment.
CBS Sports presentation of the Jiffy Lube Miami.
Field away and rolling, 43 strong for $660,000 in purse.
get ready for the Jiffy Lube 300, 200 laps, 300 miles to be run on this mile and a half track today. Going to be a handful. Weather for today's race, couldn't have it much better than we have right now, Ned.
Great day for racing here. It's warmer than they've been racing in the last several weeks when they've been racing farther north from here, but just a great day for it here.
By the way, a note for our Spanish-speaking NASCAR fans, this broadcast is available on SAP in Miami and in Houston and Harlingen, Texas, and Portland, Oregon. A whole different flavor to this event down here in Miami. Hope you are all going to enjoy it. Let's meet the contenders in this final Grand National race of the year. On the pole, ninth career pole goes to number 44, Bobby Labonte, and Elton Sawyer is right there beside him. Row two is Todd Bodine, and the winner of six races this year, Mark Martin, number 60. For row three, it's Joe Nemechek, who sat on the pole, number 87 last year, and Elliott Sadler. Row four is going to be Tim Fedewa, number 40, and Jeff Fuller. Row five, number 23, Chad Little, his last Grand National appearance. And from Vermont, Kevin LePage, number 88. In row six, it's Hermie Sadler, and the guy going for the championship, David Green, number 95. In row seven, it's Kenny Wallace and Ricky Craven. For row eight, Dale Jarrett, the defending Jiffy Lube 300 champion, number 32, and Greg Sachs. In row nine, it's Jimmy Spencer and Ted Christopher. Row 10 today, Dennis Setzer and Tracy Leslie. Row 11 is the guy that hopes to wrap up the championship, number 74, Lajoie and Jeff Green. In row 12, it's Glenn Allen and Curtis Markham. Row 13, Shane Hall, Jeremy Mayfield here. Row 14, Mark Green and David Hotto. In row 15, Rodney Combs and Kyle Petty. Row 16 is Johnny Benson Jr., last year's Grand National champion, and the winner in Winston Cup a week ago, Bobby Hamilton. Row 17, Phil Parsons and Jason Keller. Row 18 is Jeff Neal and Jeff Purvis. Row 19, Dick Trickle and Mike McLaughlin. Row 20, Derek Cope, the 1990 Daytona champion, and Michael Rich. Row 21, Randy Porter and Greg Biffle out of Oregon. Rounding out the field with a Grand National Champions provisional start, that's Larry Pearson, 43rd. Those that failed to qualify for today's race, a big list.
Big list of drivers and some very good drivers too, Ken. You see Tommy Houston down there, a guy that's run more races in this division than anyone else.
Manufacturer's breakdown for today's race, Larry McReynolds.
Chevrolet has 32 cars in the field, 8 Fords, and we have 3 Pontiacs.
Chevrolet has clinched the championship in the series. The driver's title is at stake. And then later this afternoon, the truck title from Vegas. Here's your race analysis, paying over $600,000. Last year was a slow race, 13 cautions in last year's race? And that consolation race yesterday tore up a bunch of them. Now, the in-cars for today, Mark Martin, starting in row two, position four, going to give us some wild action today. And Joe Nemechek is also back there getting ready to give us some pictures as well. He's going to be in row three, position five. Hermie Sadler's in row six, position 11 with these shots. One of the guys everybody's talking about, take one and they're going to turn him loose. Dale Jarrett won it a year ago. He's back in row 8, position 15. That's a lot better than he was last year.
Yeah, started 26 last year, so he should have it made, huh? I don't think it quite worked that way.
Here's Randy Lajoie, row 11, 21st position. Not happy with this car at all, nor is Green. They're both a little nervous about how those cars are working.
I think both of them would like to have more speed. Of course, most race drivers would like to have more speed, right, Larry, when they go out there?
Yeah, that's the thing. You know, they just hadn't run on a racetrack a lot like this. They have the one race here last year, and, you know, some of the guys are really quick in practice, especially the Winston Cup drivers.
Now, here's Phil Parsons. He's starting back in row 17, position 33. With Ned Jarrett and Larry McReynolds topside, I'm Ken Squire, Ralph Shaheen and Dick Bergren down on pit road to bring you the action of the final Grand National race. Battle for the championship and a spot at the head table, the banquet here in Miami on Monday, tomorrow night. Top 10 will make it there, and the battle from third back to 13th is as intense is that battle for nearly $250,000 for the top spot.
Yeah, Dick Trickle has no shot at getting up to third place, but he does have a shot at getting in the top 10. So a lot of juggling will go on from third through 13th position.
Let's go to Nick Berger.
Ken, you spoke a moment ago about Phil Parsons. His crew chief last year was David Hift, who this morning told Randy Lajoie that his car started 24th, finished 6th, and never passed a car. He said, be careful. Lajoie did not need a reminder. He demolished two cars last year just trying to make this race. The other guy in contention for the points championship, David Green, demolished his car last year in the last practice and crashed in the race. They didn't need any reminders. Both these guys have good memories. They both want to run all day.
Bringing them down, Bobby Labonte. Wishing them Godspeed as they come out of turn four. And you can see where the fire mark was from that Laughlin crash yesterday right there. Horrendous blaze. He was in it for over 19 seconds before he pulled himself out, burned his hands. Here's Wallace taking him down into turn number one. And that familiar number 44.
At the speed they're going into turn one this time, Ken, you'll see some side-by-side racing. It'll be interesting when they get full speed going into turn three, or especially when they get back to turn one, see if they're still able to run side-by-side.
Labonte trying to weigh and immediately being put under challenge.
Todd Bodine making a great run there.
Now watch him through this corner. Tricky part of the track right there. They've torn up, I believe, 10 cars right here in turn three. They've had a lot of paint to shellac back on that wall.
It's been really a tricky corner. You enter the corner here with so much speed, you get the car loose under braking, and then you can't get the thing turned. Again, you run out of corner, and a lot of people have had a lot of trouble in that turn three.
Todd Bodine up a spot, or rather Mark Martin up a spot. Todd Bodine up a spot as well into the lead. Martin up to third, Nemechek is fourth, and Elton Sawyer lies fifth. He started on the outside of the front row.
Trying to stay in single file here, and that's the thing that was preached at the drivers' meeting. Let's show patience, let's get some laps under our belt, and then let's go racing.
Let's talk about that drivers' meeting for just a moment this morning. Pretty intense stuff from some of those drivers.
It really was. Safety was the big issue. We've seen just some terrible crashes with the fires, and even Jimmy Spencer, forget racing. He stood up, he said, guys, let's put those gloves on. Let's put that fireproof underwear on. Let's be safe if we don't accomplish nothing else today.
Mike Laughlin was driving without gloves yesterday. Hands were badly burned in that crash when he rocketed backwards into the wall. And so many fuel tanks ruptured. I can't ever recall a weekend seeing that many fuel tanks go up in the consolation race yesterday as well as in practice the day before.
They backed hard into the wall, just square into the wall, and it's breaking the mechanism on the fuel cells, I think, is what has been happening.
Stevie Reeves, he cut a car in two, as well did Derek Cope, right in half. He had that rear wheel right up against the seat. Came back out and qualified, won the 30-lap consolation race yesterday.
Saw Elliott Sadler going by Joe Nemechek there. Elliott really had a good qualifying run here on Friday.
Todd Bodine from third spot up into the lead. It's Bobby Labonte right there in second and Mark Martin in third. A report from Ralph Shaheen here in lap four.
Ken, the other thing to add about the turns here is you watch the cars going down through the corners. Most of the drivers say the turns are actually becoming double apex corners. That means there's two centers to the turn. When you turn it in for the first time, the car is tight and it tends to push. Then you have to turn it even more to the left to get through the second portion of the turn. That's where the rear end of the car gets loose and it comes around. The problem then becomes, because of the speeds in the turns, the driver's not going flush into the wall like they did last year. They're backing him in.
So far, so good. And a year ago at this time, we were already under caution. We're working lap number five with Todd Bodine showing the way. He and Bobby Labonte have pulled away. They've got themselves almost 2 seconds on Mark Martin running in the third position. Back there in fourth is Elliott Sadler. Then comes Nemechek, followed by Tim Fedewa, Elton Sawyer, Chad Little to eighth, Kevin LePage ninth, and Jeff Fuller in tenth. So Mark, four, five laps down. Five complete, and thus far, nose to tail, everybody on their toes, very alert, and a very good first five laps, Ned.
Things have been very quiet, and I know the NASCAR officials are very proud of that, and we are too. Good to see everybody using some patience here in the early going.
Back here with Lajoie, and he's getting caught up in cars going by him. This is not what he wanted.
That was Kyle Petty just went by there. Kyle Petty
running
a rare.
That was when he backed into 24th. would put him into 24th. And there is David Green, and he's up in 14th, and the war is still on for this national championship. Lajoie has got to get the Spurs into that number 74. He has not been happy, nor has his crew chief, Steve Bird, with that car since they got here. Back on Thursday when I talked to him, he said, I'm just going to run like I always do, flat out. It's the only way I know to go. And the word was, how are they going to make Lajoie conservative enough not to tear the car up here, and how they're going to put the spurs on David Green to make him more aggressive. Well, right now, Lajoie has a headache. That number 74, I'm sure, is not running the way he wants it. Look at them pull by him.
Because he has to be so careful not to get into trouble.
Well, he's back to 25th now, Ned.
Yeah.
He's backed up several. He's backed up four positions.
Yeah, you can rest assured the car is not working the way that he would like for it to, or he would be more aggressive than he is.
Only 33 points separate Lajoie from the 1994 national champion David Green, making his last performance. He and car owner Buzz McCall moving into Winston Cup racing for 1997. Jimmy Spencer, number 20, rolls onto pit road, a leading contender to win this race. And the guy who made that heartfelt speech this morning about safety in this event at the drivers' meeting. Back with the leaders.
And these guys has pulled to a 2.5-second lead over the third place Mark Martin.
Spencer apparently had a left side tire to go down.
You're riding with Mark Martin, and there's the interval that he has to catch up to go after those two leaders. He talked about the rig being a little loose. This is the car he loves so much, and yet he says it's pure vanilla. He says there's nothing special about this car. Now watch him as he takes it through the turns. Second to third, back here to Martin, is 2 1/10 of a second.
A lot of times when a car is loose at the very beginning of a run at a track like Homestead, that's not so bad, because as it burns fuel off and the tires get a little heat in them, it'll begin to turn less and less as the race goes on.
Talking about burning the fuel off, close to 8 pounds per gallon. You got 22 gallons in there to begin with, so that is a lot of weight behind the wheel.
And it gains a lot of front percentage as you burn that fuel down, and that'll really make a car not turn.
Jam session into turn one. And there's some of them getting around too wide in that first corner out there, Larry. Meanwhile, up in front, Todd Bodine seeking that 10th Grand National win. Having a very good go.
Ken, the fans are normally used to seeing Todd Bodine in the 81 car, but they put his teammate Jeff Neal in the 81 car. That way the 81 number was guaranteed a starting position in this field, and it did exercise a provisional spot. So Todd Bodine qualified the 82 car.
Take a look at the Jeff Green car getting under Greg Sachs.
Jeff Green is on the move in that Dale Earnhardt-owned car. He is now up to the 16th position. He started back in 22nd position.
Spencer well off the pace now after that pit stop. Let's go to Ralph Shaheen on Jimmy Spencer.
Yeah, and this is the reason why Jimmy had to come in. This is the rear tire off the car. You can see it has ripped the outer layer right off. The inner layer is still okay. That is the inner liner. That's what was allowed him to come into the pits. This tire, obviously no good. You can see the steam still coming off.
Jimmy Spencer got a lap to make up out here now. He's got a lot more work to do than he had intended for this afternoon.
He was one of the ones that was really happy with his car yesterday. In fact, he quit practice just a little bit early and said, I believe I'm ready to race. But he's got a long way to go now to make up that lap.
He's a lap down in 43rd position, trying to wind his way back through this field. Kevin LePage moves into fourth. We'll tell you that story when we return. Back with you once again. 15 laps have been completed at Homestead, the Metro-Dade Homestead Motorsports Complex. And Todd Bodine, who placed Tracy Leslie in this ride, is out in front by a length and a half as he holds that pole sitter, Bobby Labonte, who set a new track record in qualifying. Came in here at 139 mile an hour clip to take the pole. The top three cars in qualifying broke the old track record. And that track record was held not by the pole sitter Nemechek, but by Dale Jarrett from the year back. He didn't make it the first day. Second day, qualified 26 and set the record.
How about every car in the field broke the track record? Every car that made the field broke the track record from last year. So just
from a 136.
Yeah.
Bobby Labonte, Elton Sawyer, Todd Bodine. Those top three that did it, and then the rest came along with them.
Yeah.
With that additional area on the inside.
While we was talking about that, Bobby Labonte took the lead from Ty Bodine going off into turn one.
So Bobby Labonte is back in front another time. This is where he started, but Todd Bodine had put him away early.
They're running some pretty good laps out here, too. Surprising that they're still in the 39-second bracket now. Bobby Labonte set on the pole with a lap time of 39.08. But Larry, they're running about 39.60 now. That's pretty good after having run 17, 18 laps.
This is the same tire that Goodyear had from the Winston Cup cars at Phoenix, and we saw the same thing. The tire really had good staying power. A lot of things could play a role in today's outcome, but I don't think tire wear is going to play a role in it. Certainly pit strategy could, but I don't think tires are going to be an issue. We might even see a lot of two-tire stops today under pit stops.
First race that Todd Bodine has led this season since New Hampshire back in July. And now Bobby Labonte's taking it back. Let's go back to the number one. That's Hermie Sadler. He's running in 13th spot. And right behind him in 14th, David Green, followed by Christopher in the 31. And right now, the way they're running with Green in the 14th position, moving up on Hermie Sadler. And Randy Lajoie back in 22nd. That point battle is still in LaJoy's favor. 12 points, something like that, the difference between first and second. The overall points, we'll give it to you in a sec. LaJoie being shown 22nd. Now it's minus nine. LaJoie still has that lead. Had some tight point battles before. This one could be right in there with them.
Ned, you've seen points battles. You've been in points battles. Don't you think this is a good game plan, though? It's a 200-lap event. They just got to run their own race. As they get to a car and they can pass it, don't get themselves in trouble, but go by it and just let the laps of this race wind down.
I agree. I think David Green was quoted as saying, you know, I got to run 150 laps and then go racing the last 50 laps. They, as Mark Martin said in the interview at the top, you got to be there at the end before you have a shot at winning the race. So they got to be there at the end before they got a shot at winning the championship.
Saw Tim Fedewa for just a moment in eighth position. The point story here, it's the same point structure as you would see in Winston Cup racing. The big difference is they don't give those additional points for leading the most laps out here in this event.
Exactly. And Mark Martin has now caught the leaders. He was running, a couple of 3 seconds behind there a little while ago. Look at there. You see them all in the picture. Bobby Labonte leading. Todd Bodine second. And there we look out the windshield. Mark Martin, as he has run them down.
Bobby Labonte up in front. That battle continuing to seesaw back and forth in the 44 and 82. It's now Labonte with that lead.
Look like they're pretty much running about the same groove. They go right down to the bottom of the racetrack, going to the corner and let it drift up, especially on those short shoots.
David Green, Christopher, and here comes Jeff Green, all getting under Hermie Sadler in the number one as Hermie backs up three spots. Puts him back to 16th. David Green now up to 12th.
So Kenny Wallace leading that pack of cars. He is, I guess, the driver today, more laps than anyone else here a year ago. Kenny sitting back there in the 11th position now.
So now you have David Green up to 12th, and you have LaJoie in 22nd. We'll check those numbers off for you. This point battle is a beauty.
Greg Sachs getting pretty sideways there off the corner, made just a little bit of contact with the Ted Christopher car.
Boy, take a look at this, the 99, the 85, all in there, that Shane Hall in 17 position, and the 99 of Glenn Allen Jr. Elton Sawyer's back in that group now. After starting up on the very front, he's going to run the full season next year, back with the team that he ran the Aiken-Sims team of a year ago, 2 years ago.
Mark Martin making a pass down into turn one for second.
Here's Mark Martin trying to make a move on that lead.
But this is the David Green and Kenny Wallace battle right there, but you see Martin has already moved around the Todd Bodine car. So Martin, I think he sat there and sort of got the feel of that car, Larry, and settled down and gained that 2.5 seconds he was behind, just ran up on him in a hurry. And
definitely let things kind of sort out, let these guys find where they was going to run, and then here he comes.
Lajoie still leads in the point battle by nine. By 9 points. Lajoie over Green as it tightens up. Tightening up for the lead. There's Elton Sawyer way back now. He's in 19th position. Ralph Shaheen has a story on what the condition is there.
Bob Sutton is half a Sutton Aiken Motorsport, the chosen car of Elton Sawyer. You started second, you're all the way back to 11th. What's the problem, Bob?
Well, we're just a little bit loose right now. You know, we've seen some bad situations here this week, and Elton just wanted to be careful here and make sure we got a car for the end of the race. But I think we're going to be fine. We'll make a little bit of adjustment here when we come in to stop, put tires and gas in it. Barbersol along for next year.
Ken, they're a team that's trying to be patient right now, but they are desperately in need of a yellow.
So there's a move put on the 99, and that's going to set Glenn Allen back. Elton Sawyer getting through on him and trying to bring Randy Lajoie along. Take a look up in front. Scooting down into turn number three as we work lap number 25. You have Bobby Labonte deployed first and Mark Martin in second.
Kevin LePage has joined this group. He's moved up into fourth position right behind Todd Bodine and Mark Martin. His car has really been working good, and he's been coming this entire race.
He is really wild. They've got a brand new sponsorship, a whole new program for next year, and he has made up about a quarter of a track over these first 26 laps. That's LePage now running in fourth. CBS Sports coverage of the Jiffy Lube Miami 300 continues after this message and a word from your local station. Lap 28, we get ourselves a new leader out here. Mark Martin back in that familiar first spot for car number 60 and trying to draw away. And his biggest story, Kevin LePage, he's pulled himself up into second spot. Take a look at this pass for the lead.
This was on lap 29 as they went into, came off of turn four. You see Martin make the move right down on the inside of Bobby Labonte. And back there on the right side of your screen, here comes Kevin LePage moving around the Todd Bodine car. All at the same time.
From Mark Martin's perspective. Got himself first spot right there. Change of drivers right here. The one we've been looking for.
Cautions on the speedway.
Oh, boy. They had hoped,
oh, what a tough one. Break. Yeah, terrible break.
They'd hope to get a caution so they could make that driver change. And here they are. Getting it as they're in the pits, and a lot of cars torn. There's Rodney Combs in car number 43. It looks like the Curtis Martin car number 63 was involved.
Kyle Petty is
David Hutto, number 97. Yeah, I saw Hutto. Johnny Benson involved as well.
This is at turn one, just at the entrance of turn two. It started in one, took several hundred feet to come to a halt. It happens in lap number 31.
A lot of damage on the David Hutto car.
46 and a half miles before the first caution, and it's a biggie. There you see the 77, of Setzer.
Yeah, there's a lot of damage to his car.
Randy Lajoie pitting immediately in number 74.
Derek Cope with a lot of damage front and rear.
I believe Randy Lajoie was involved. Yeah, he's got damage to that
car. Sure has.
A lot of damage to the right-hand side. There you see they're going to put on right side tires.
This could be a major blow to this championship drive.
You're watching him in the car.
He'd been running right in the middle of that thick pack, and that's where you can get in trouble. Most likely, he's right in the middle of a big group of cars.
Five cars collected. The 74 kept on. It starts out and stops. He's all the way down on the end of pit road.
I think the stop and go paddle
stop and
has stopped
paddle
him because
out.
All the cars have
there
not gone by
it.
Yet.
Lajoie's view. Let's see what happened out here.
And it looks like, was that the 97 car that got up on the wall?
David Hutto.
Just come down and gathered Randy Lajoie.
And apparently then a lot of others got involved behind him.
Dale Jarrett can give us some pictures too.
Now this happened in front of Dale Jarrett. See, he was at the back of a big pack of cars, and you see the sheet metal flying, the car spinning, and he don't know where to go, but he just drives right through the middle and gets on through.
He was grabbing gears and on the brakes.
Well, he was fortunate.
Saw a lot of sheet metal damage to the right side of Randy LaJoie's car as he heads back on the pit road. The key will be that sheet metal damage certainly could affect him here as long as it hadn't hit that right front wheel or that right rear wheel and messed the toe out up.
Greg Biffle's number 51 was also involved. But the luckiest man here, I think, is LaJoie that he didn't get caught more. He's coming back in to make a second stop. Doesn't want to get trapped a lap down. But they've got some work to do trying to get some of the aero back on that one. 74, Steve Bird, the crew chief. And let's follow the action here as the man currently number one in the Grand National points brings his car back in for additional repair. Dick?
Well, Bertie said that the car seems all right mechanically, Ken. That's Steve Bird, the crew chief. He is working on the right front with a Roush roller trying to get the fender out of that tire. He thinks the chassis alignment is all right. You know, Randy LaJoie said he has not been comfortable since he got to Homestead. He said, this morning I'm feeling a little bit better. This is why he has not been comfortable. He has been very, very worried about exactly this kind of thing happening to him and potentially knocking him out of his championship.
Back in 34th position at the present time, and David Green stays 10th on the field. David Green in 10th and LaJoie in 34th.
What Steve Bird's doing here, he's got that roller and he's having Randy real slowly go forward, and that's rolling the fender off that tire because that's real important that they don't restart this race and he has a tire rubbing.
Take another view from Randy LaJoie's viewpoint of how close. Ooh.
David Hutto up out of the groove, got real loose, hit the outside retaining wall, come back down. There just was nowhere for Randy LaJoie to go.
Good save by LaJoie. Hutto, who won here in the Baby Grands a year ago. They had their finale on this track, and he won the national championship on this track. Bad luck today for him.
Had to take
35 laps are complete. Major caution, 52 and a half of the 300 miles have been run. Now Jared has another look for us from Hermie Sadler's car as to what happened.
Okay, as he looks out ahead, Ken, you can see a car up here high on the outside getting up in the wall. That's David Hutto, car number 77. He's going to careen back across the track as Randy LaJoie will come by, and he comes right down into Randy LaJoie. Right there, you see him hit him, and Hermie Sadler scoots on by up on the outside.
And they're still working on that number 74, trying to get some of the aerodynamics back. Dick Bergen with more.
Well, Ken, this is the tire and wheel that came off the right rear of Randy LaJoie's car. He obviously took a big hit, and even though Bertie, the crew chief, said the front end is all right, Larry McReynolds, big hit like this, would that knock the rear end out of alignment and cause that thing to not handle?
Well, Dick, it really should, but if I saw a wheel like that come off of our race car, probably the biggest fear I would have is what it maybe did to the axle or possibly the gear. So it'll be interesting to watch this car to make sure it don't have an axle or a gear problem later on in this event.
Change in points. Green now leads by 40 for the national championship with Green in 10th and LaJoie 34. Here's your race summary after 54 miles have been completed here today. Four different leaders, lead change four times, and the average speed stayed up there at 115 miles an hour, but that's being whittled down by this long caution. Four laps thus far for a 10-car calamity coming out of turn number one at the Metro-Dade Homestead Motorsports Complex, and one of the folks out of the race is standing by with Ralph Shaheen.
That is Derek Cope, the Babcock Ford driver. What happened out there, Derek?
Well, it looked like somebody got spun around there up in the middle of that turn one and two, and, you know, we just started to check up. We saw it pretty early, and somebody from behind didn't, you know, and got into us, spun us around, and then I think Mark Green got spun around into us. So it was just one of them deals, you know. There's just not a lot of room, and, you know, everybody couldn't stop fast enough.
Are they being overly aggressive, or are they heeding the words from the driver's meeting of being patient?
No, I think that everybody was doing a real good job. It looked like, from my standpoint, everybody was, you know, giving and taking real well out there, and it just happened that you could see the pack starting to come close together again. Everybody's kind of backing up on tires, and then, you know, tight racing, and that's what happens.
Dick Bergen?
Well, Randy LaJoie has been in five times under this yellow flag, Ralph. They've pulled the sheet metal out from the right front fender, pulled it out from the right rear. The mechanics have been underneath the car. There's all sorts of sheet metal damage there. They've taped it up, used bungee cords. I asked Steve Bird how he thought the car was. Birdie said he thought it was okay, and I said, why are you guys riding in the back? He said, we have been trying to stay out of trouble. Hasn't worked very well so far.
Sometimes that can really bite you, because if anything happens, you can get collected. Here was the example. This car that LaJoie is driving was third in Milwaukee and one in New Hampshire in its two previous appearances, and they thought it was going to run well here. That was not the case in the outset, and fighting this car all along. We're showing 39 laps complete as they come by this time, and that'll bring us to 58 and a half miles, 161 laps to go. The big story of the moment is Shelburne, Vermont's Kevin LePage, who's brought his Chevrolet up front. They announced a new sponsor for the entire season next year in Grand National, and they're going to run five Winston Cup races as well. Now let's take a look at that point battle. Look at that. What a dramatic change. This is the latest update. David Green now back in front to win his second national crown by 37 over Lajoie.
Ken, there were at least 10 cars involved in that melee over turn two. Of course, Randy Lajoie in the points lead is the one that we focused on, but there were a lot of cars that had a lot of damage to them over there. Some of them behind the wall. We saw Derek Cope back there. Johnny Benson is out of the race, but also with heavy damage is Mark Green, the Biddle car, the Rodney Combs car, Dennis Setzer car, Curtis Markham. Jason Keller had some damage. He's been in the pit several times, made repairs on his car. So just a lot of cars with a lot of damage.
They seem to be doing so well for so long out here. Yeah. They were really paying attention, taking heed of what had happened in the last 2 days.
Well, I think Derek Cope hit the nail on the head. As they've run for a while now and the tires were getting heat up, the cars were beginning to slip around a little bit. And I don't know, it didn't show on any of the in-car camera views that we had that anybody hit David Hutto. It looked like they might have just got a little high in the turn up in what they call the loose stuff, and around she went.
Coming down to complete 40 and go back under Green after the first caution of the day.
Kevin LePage is the leader. He Jimmy took the Spencer. Lead right there before that accident.
Jimmy Spencer trying to get his lap back on the outside with those leaders as they pour it on into turn number one. Don't forget, after this Grand National Championship affair at Homestead, Florida, it's off to Las Vegas this afternoon. The Craftsman NASCAR trucks will decide their championship in our big championship doubleheader Sunday on CBS. Now number 60, there is Mark Martin right down on the bottom another time, scooting through and taking that first position. Here comes Jimmy Spencer trying to make his lap up.
Jimmy knows if he's going to make his lap up, this is probably going to be one of the best opportunities that he has right here after this restart.
Because the front runners, Mark Martin, Kevin LePage, and those guys, the first 10 or so, did not come in for pit stops. A lot of the cars back in the field did come in, those that were on the lead lap. And there goes Spencer around. He's back on the lead lap right now.
Right on the bottom. Took that short shoot. Now there's a guy that must have run at Flemington, New Jersey on that four-corner track up there.
Here you see Todd Bodine moving to the inside of Mark Martin. Kevin LePage follows, going off into turn three.
Great scrap as Todd Bodine goes back into first, drags Kevin LePage along with him, and Jimmy Spencer has made up his lap. Now Spencer is running on the tail end in 30th position, and that means that Lajoie has gone down a lap. He's been caught once and gone down one. Not looking good for the New Englander, Lajoie, and Jeff Green is in eighth. His brother David running for the title in ninth. The Green brothers, nose to tail.
Well, there's no one that he'd rather be running with out there than his brother running close to on this treacherous racetrack.
That's the thing. He's moved himself into ninth, and this is a good position because I got to believe his strategy's got to change here a little bit. He knows that Randy Lajoie's had a problem. He's getting himself up near the front where you're probably going to be more apt to stay out of trouble.
Looking over Charles Simmons' shoulder, the flagman here, as they come down the main straightaway, completing 43 laps.
Joe Nemechek moving by Mark Martin. Moves into the fourth position, actually the third position.
And Todd Bodine looked like has blown something. Was that Todd Bodine? There's smoke coming from a car.
Down the backstretch, it was Todd Bodine. There's the 88, Kevin LePage diving to the inside. You see the Todd Bodine car holding on.
Well, he's running okay now, but I swear I thought I saw some smoke from that car. Okay, we'll see. Maybe it was just... Maybe he got a little sideways or something. It was tire smoke, but as it came off of turn two, there was smoke, and I thought he'd blown the engine or something.
Now, they've taken the side window out of these Grand National cars for this event. They came in intending to run them, Larry.
And I think they did that for a couple of reasons. One thing, if we do have a situation like we saw yesterday with the fire, it gives the driver another exit route to get out of that race car. Also, we're down here in Miami. It's 80-something degrees. Humidity's probably just as much. It's really hot in these race cars.
How hot?
To Dale Jarrett yesterday. We're probably looking at temperatures 130, 140 degrees. He said that's been a good move, taking that wind out. The speed slowed down here in the corners enough that probably the right side window was not going to play effect if the car gets sideways.
Take a look and see what happened to Todd Bodine here a moment ago from Mark Martin's view.
See, there is.
Ooh.
There was smoke. It must have been tire smoke, maybe, you think, Larry?
Well, I believe I looked down there, Ned, and there's some quick dry down in that corner. He may have just run through that quick dry and
got
put up a bunch of smoke.
Got it below the line a little.
Okay. But he's running okay now. But scary moment there for him.
Guy that's running well is LePage. Here he is trying to put a lap on Jimmy Spencer. Kevin LePage leading this event. Coming in with a new sponsor next year, a European group. And he is trying to put a lap on Spencer, who is in 30th position. Spencer's just made up his lap, but he's under heavy pressure here as they dive into turn number one. Bodine right there with Nemechek in third.
Well, that is some hard chargers running together there. Spencer, LePage, Todd Bodine.
Jimmy making that car very wide coming down that backstretch.
Yeah,
oh, he wanted to stay up there,
there.
But he couldn't do it. LePage is just simply too strong.
Kevin LePage, who started in 10th this afternoon, still looking for that first Grand National victory. He's been close. He was second up there at Michigan. Likes these big tracks. Yeah, from up top side here, down across the finish line, and you see this just about sold out house. 65,000, they say, have gathered here for this Grand National finale. We've got one car on pit road. Mark Green has just brought, one of the Green brothers, has just brought number 37 on pit road and back out again. Here's Ralph Sheehan.
Ken, as we reported earlier, Mike Wallace is now driving relief of Jeff Purvis. Jeff was involved in an incident earlier in the weekend where he broke his thumb on his right hand, and he's also very sore in his back. Well, he came into the medical center right after he got out of the car. He went a little longer than he thought he would. They're just checking him out. He seems to be okay. He's just very, very tender in all the areas that are sore.
Purvis had a terrible wreck. He was another one. He knocked the front end off his car. And when he knocked it out, it wasn't just the front flip, it was the rig.
That was a terrible break. He was sitting on pit road making the driver change when that caution came out for that accident.
If you never know when the caution is going to come out, but if he could have just hung on for another couple laps, he could still be there in the lead lap. And now they're three laps down.
Bobby Hamilton is in 17th, Elliott Sadler 18th, Randy Porter 19th, Jeremy Mayfield is in 20th, Jason Keller 21st, Dale Jarrett back there in 22nd, which is about where he was last year. He didn't make any big moves till halfway in this event.
It was a while before he made his moves, but his car hasn't been working too good today, Ken. They did make a pit stop during that caution period. It appears to be a little bit better now than it was before, but he was sort of fading backwards before then.
Green has dropped back, this is David Green, to 14th. Lajoie is in 31st. And you give Green the national championship by 18 points in this seesaw battle for the national title. Watching it live here on CBS. And coming up, the Craftsman Trucks will be at Las Vegas on that beautiful new track to decide their national championship this afternoon. Big championship Sunday doubleheader on CBS.
Ned Dale was one of the drivers at the driver's meeting that stood up and preached patience to these guys, and he said, I'm walking proof that the fastest car don't always win the race here at Homestead.
He was right last year. He was not the fastest, just in the right place at the right time.
LePage drawing out by a big advantage. He gets himself about 10 or 12 lengths over the second place man, Todd Bodine. And this is David Green in the Buzz McCall, the cat car, number 95. He has dropped back to 15th now.
Yeah, it was a little surprising to me, Ken. Yeah, I think he's just exercising patience. But a little surprising to me that more drivers didn't pit during that caution. That was about 35 laps or so, and that's over 50 miles. So they'll have a pit stop coming up here, in the next 15 or 20 laps?
Yeah, we're at 76 and a half miles now of the 300 to be run.
We've just completed lap 51. Most of the crew chiefs told me that they could run about 70 or 75 laps, so we could see some green flag stops in the next 15 to 20 laps.
You saw Curtis Markham's number 63. That car all torn up front and rear from that 10-car incident below, just out of turn one, getting into turn two.
Goodyear has given these teams three sets of tires, three per position to change under caution. Now, under green, they can change as many tires as they want, but they have three sets of tires that they can change under caution.
Hey, Larry, if you want a chance to win a trip to the 1997 Busch Class, oh, you've already won a trip to the Busch Class.
We got two trips coming there.
But if you'd like to win a trip, you folks that are with us today, you can be the honorary starter for the race. Stay right here. We'll give you the story. We'll give you the story at halfway mark in the event. And here's Bodine back around for the lead. That's what, his third crack or second crack at first place.
They still haven't been able to put Jimmy Spencer a lap down. Jimmy's in the white, number 20, running right in front of the leader.
Pretty hard to get around Jimmy, isn't it?
Yeah.
He's got his mind made up.
I would say he's one of the toughest to put down a lap when he's trying to make up a lap as he is right here.
Now you see Mark Martin closing back in on Nemechek, the third spot. Number 87, Joe Nemechek, pole sitter a year ago, had a great race in this event. And from Nemechek's bumper, looking back at six-time winner this year and only 13 starts, Mark Martin. I loved, right out to the wall. How about that one, man?
I think Mark Martin exercised a great deal of patience on that restart. He was sitting there in second place, but the traffic was heavy, and they were all jockeying around, Spencer trying to get back in the lead lap and all those kind of things. And he said, I don't believe I want to get up there and run too hard at this point of the race. I'll let things settle down here a little bit, and then I'll pick my way back up. And
close racing. And, you know, Mark's car, it was a little better after some laps at the beginning of the race. Mm-hmm. As he moves past Joe Nemechek as they go off into turn three.
Well, I would think that number 60, Mark Martin, had steak for breakfast today. See Nemechek check up just a little getting in there? Dick Berger.
Ken, a couple smart guys up there in the booth right beside you. I've just talked to Bobby Leslie, who is the crew chief for Mark Martin. He says it takes our cars several laps to come in after the tires cool off. At least six. Leslie said that's part of why the car dropped back. Anytime you see a caution flag, it's going to take Mark a while to catch up. That could play in this event as we get closer to the checkered flag.
Here's Todd Bodine. We're a long way from that checkered flag right now. Commanding. Here you see Nemechek a little further back. He continues to square it off. And there's the 88 of Kevin LePage in second spot. Todd Bodine, one win, Grand National Racing at South Boston. With the advantage, and Jimmy Spencer begins to lumber away from those two fighting for first place. Spencer on the tail end, now shown in 29th position. Tail end of the lead lap.
And for the fans that might have just tuned in, Spencer got a lap down when he had a flat tire, had to come in during green flag conditions and change tires.
Working lap number 57 here this afternoon. Working lap 61 of 200. And Kevin LePage is putting on the race of his career. He's out in front right behind Jimmy Spencer, who is on the tail end of the lead lap. The second place car is Todd Bodine, and there in third is Mark Martin. But for the moment, it's Kevin LePage in the 88 who cut his teeth on Vermont short tracks, won the Milk Bowl three times.
Really?
Vermont's biggest race, yeah. There he is out in front cutting down to the inside. His wife Donna used to be car owner and the crew chief for them. Still very much a part of that team. LePage has led three times for 21 laps thus far in that C.R. Miller effort. He's the crew chief on the car. David Riddling, the car owner.
Really working on Jimmy Spencer coming off turn two. Looks like he might win the drag race into turn three.
Got it.
Puts Jimmy down another lap, or back down a lap.
Not for long.
Spencer is not going to give up.
That's all it took. Wake up call. Just get close to him and he's right back there. What a show these Grand National cars are putting on. We're at Homestead, Florida, Dade Metro. And they're stacking them up three wide into turn number one. National championship is at stake. David Green has overwhelmed Lajoie for that, but it's a long way to go. You see the standings further back after 60 of 200 laps have been completed. Pearson back there in 34th. Combs got collected in that 10-car wreck in the 43 down here at turn one. Drivers all walked away from that one, and no fire, thank goodness. Several major fires over the last couple of days when they backed them into the wall. There's Phil Parsons in the number 10. Let's see where Phil is running today. 13th. Back with the leaders. Mark Martin up to second spot, Ned. Good move.
I think his car is beginning to come in. Things are looking pretty good there for him to make those moves. And as they say, his car is running a little bit better the longer they run. So here he comes.
Fifth here last year. Let's check back on Randy Lajoie, see how he's doing. He's at 30th. Lajoie is running in 30th. Caution is out. There is another caution, second one of the day.
Hey, this is going to be a break for Jimmy Spencer. He comes off of turn four in front of the leader. So that puts him in the lead lap. He'll get to go all the way around, a mile and a half.
This is a break for Jimmy Spencer, and this is a break for those leaders because we was in about a 10-lap window of them having to make a green flag pit stop.
Exactly.
David Green running in 15th. 15 positions behind him. Randy Lajoie in that battle for the national crown. Dick Trickle brings the number 64 onto pit road.
He might have come down a little bit early, Ken. I don't think pit road was open yet.
Cost him.
The pace car has just picked the field up over in turn two.
Got the whole paddle up in front of him. 33rd position when Dick Trickle came onto pit road. Well, Kevin LePage keeps knocking on the door, getting those second places, running up in front and leading events. And I've never seen him more excited about an upcoming season than about the plans for next year. Now here comes the field on the pit road. Comes at a perfect time. 64 laps have been completed.
They enter pit road going into turn three. Now what'll be interesting here, we may see some two-tire stops, but I believe with 64 laps on the board, a smart move would be to get four here because this actually puts them into a fuel window where one more stop could get them to the end of the race.
96 miles have been completed as the leaders pull onto pit road at the mile and a half. Dade Metro Homestead Motorsports Complex. Great race. Todd Bodine in the pits.
All of the leaders in.
Watching LePage. They're the top three cars all being serviced. Here is Dick Bergen with Mark Martin.
Ken, they're not going to adjust this chassis at all. They are very happy with it. Steve Meehl, Bobby Leslie, Jimmy Fenwick, three crew chiefs had a conversation about what to do here, and they went to scuff tires rather than putting brand new tires on it. Let's get down to Todd Bodine.
Well, John Fabian and the crew already done servicing this car. They took a little air out of the right rear tire. It was a little loose coming off the turns. They hope that will help him out. They hadn't planned on pitting until lap 70. They did take four tires.
Field being reorganized in the 66th lap. We all come in under caution. We'll be back with more of the action in a moment.
Second round. Bright light city, gonna set my soul, gonna set my soul on fire. Viva!
Coming up next on CBS Sports, the NASCAR Truck Series Championship battle to be decided when Ron Hornaday, Jack Sprague, and the 95 champion Mike Skinner square off at the CarQuest Auto Parts 420K. Yeah, 18th or better could do it for Hornaday today.
Well, you know, that don't sound too complicated. Finish 18th or better out there, but he has a chance of encountering the same type of problem that Randy Lajoie has encountered here today.
And I'll tell you what else is going to be great out there. You've got Bill Elliott, Darrell Waltrip, right there, 11th and 12th in this race. A lot of great Winston Cup stars are out there. A.J. Foyt's in the back of the field getting cranked up for another one this afternoon. Spotters are ready on a restart. 68 laps when they come by will have been completed of the 200 to be running. You're looking down into turn four of the mile and a half. Dade Metro, Homestead Motorsports Complex. Kevin LePage, who had been leading after that pit stop, fell from first to 10th due to a relatively slow stop. He was in 25 and 8/10 seconds.
That's Randy Lajoie now that brings the leaders to the green flag. That puts him back on the lead lap at the tail end of the lead lap.
He definitely needs a caution right away.
This is it.
Let's check on David Green as well. He's back in 17th spot. See Tim Fedewa right there with him, just behind him in the 18th spot, followed by Phil Parsons. Here's Dick Berger.
Ken, I just took a walk down there to David Green's pit, and it is all smiles. Crew chief Butch Enders says we are right on course. They made no adjustments through four new tires, not scuff tires, four new tires added, and a can of gas, and they have smiles on their faces because they are headed for a championship. Ralph Shaheen.
Well, Dick, we just checked in with the crew at Dale Jarrett's. Now, they came in and they took tires just about 28 laps ago. They only took gas on this current stock. The tires are good for about 50 laps before they start wearing out a little bit. You can only go 84 laps on the gas. So one way or the other, Dale Jarrett is going to have to pit at least for fuel.
That second caution of the day was for debris at the start-finish line area. That was a stop for a piece of metal that was down here under Carl Simmons' flag stand. Back with the leaders another time. Mark Martin is there. Glenn Allen Jr. in second. Dale Jarrett third. Todd Bodine, Jason Keller, and Bobby Hamilton.
And here comes Glenn Allen.
Ooh.
Trying to take the lead. And Todd Bodine goes down on the inside. Is he going to be able to make it into the turn? I think he will. Allen will have to back off.
Whoa.
It's a good thing that straightaway wasn't just a little bit shorter.
From Mark Martin's view. Looking over this battle up in front, Glenn Allen Jr. running for that rookie title, and what a job he's been doing in 1996. Down the back straightaway, 2,100 feet long. Into turn three, there's Todd Bodine, Glenn Allen right there, and Mark Martin. And just behind them, Dave.
Glenn Allen made a great move coming off the turn four to get around Mark Martin, but Todd Bodine had the momentum. He picked up the draft for both of them, and here he came. Mark Martin's car seemed to be pushing a little bit coming off the turns right now.
But Ned, this is not unusual. We've seen this at every restart. He's got those four fresh tires. It'll be interesting to watch him about 10 to 15 laps from now. We'll probably see him coming back.
I think you're right.
Mark Martin looking over those top two, Todd Bodine and Glenn Allen. Mark says, I'll take advantage of any weakness, whatever it may be. It may be different to different cars. I'll try and find it. Here he is looking for it as he follows the 99. Glenn Allen Jr., rookie of the year, led his first lap of the season just a moment ago. You saw it right here at Homestead.
But that lead was short-lived because when he got to turn one after crossing the start-finish line in front, he was in second.
Pretty good battle to third here. There comes Dale Jarrett seeking that third position from Mark Martin.
This is a prime example. Maybe Dale's car is not handling exactly like he would like it, but what he got out of what he did while ago on pit road, he got that track position. There's just no substitute for track position.
So important, especially on the
pine. Mark Martin in third. You're riding with Dale Jarrett in fourth, and behind him is Elton Sawyer, followed by Jason Keller in sixth, Chad Little seventh, and Kevin LePage back to eighth. Joe Nemechek up to ninth. Bobby Labonte up to 10th. Ooh, Rodney Combs' car isn't going to make it. We're going to get a third caution right now.
What a break for Randy Lajoie. He gets his lap back. He is back on the lead lap right here.
Rodney Combs, number 43. Looking like a Saturday night street stop out there. Front end all abused, hashed up.
And the four car also that was started by Jeff Purvis had lost some time when they changed drivers. He's going to get one of his laps back as well.
There's the 74. You were riding with Randy Lajoie as he came across the line and made up that lap. Big break for Lajoie.
I can speak for the crew chief. There ain't a better feeling in the world to know you need a caution and you get it just when you need it.
If those are pretty long odds. That's down there rolling twos and threes.
But they got it, and they're back on the lead lap.
Well, Rodney's car looks a little sad out there in the back straightaway. And CBS Sports coverage of the Jiffy Lube 300 continues after this message and a word from your local station.
Allison throws the block. Tail hits him. He slides. Donnie Allison slides. They get again. They drive in the turn. They're hitting the wall. They're head on the wall. Petty is out in front at the line. Petty wins it. And there's a fight between Cale Yarborough and Donnie Allison. Down they come for the finish. Here comes Baker on the outside. Bill Elliott. Three cars side by side fighting at the line. Cale Yarborough does it.
Oh, when did they turn a 500?
When did they turn a 500?
Darrell, how long?
I
committed. Thank God.
Dale Jarrett's going to win the Daytona 500.
The Great American Race coming Sunday, February 16th, high noon on CBS. And to continue on CBS, to the Millennium. We're thrilled about having it here for several years to come. The old Daytona 500. Now, there's no other day like it in the world of motorsports. Hope you'll be with us to enjoy it this coming February. We're live here at Homestead this afternoon on a doubleheader NASCAR Championship Sunday. Grand National cars, the Busch cars out here now, the Craftsman Truck Series ready to roll in Vegas. Buddy Baker and Mike Joyce standing by to bring you that action later this afternoon. Coming around, 77 laps complete and ready to go back under green. Big story at the moment is that Lajoie is back in the lead lap with a crack at getting back up close to David Green in this battle for the championship. But up in front of the restart, it's Todd Bodine in the lead. Glenn Allen Jr. in second. Mark Martin is third. Rodney Combs' car was brought in after it stopped midway down the backstretch and brought out that third caution of the afternoon.
And he just came back out of the garage and go back out on the track. So apparently whatever it was that caused him to stop, they got it fixed. And Dick Bergman has more on that.
Randy Lajoie came in and hit it right after having taken the lead, and that was a great opportunity for him because he was able to fire four fresh tires at the car. Nothing to lose because he would have been at the back of the pack anyway at the caution flag. So here's Lajoie out there with a real legitimate crack at this championship still.
Back in the lead lap, it's Randy Lajoie in the number 74 trying to close back up on David Green, the 1994 Grand National Champion. Great driver out of Owensboro, Kentucky. Currently runs in 14th position. And Lajoie is setting sail. He's already picked up two spots. He's gone to 28th. And he's closing on Ted Christopher in the number 28, Christopher in the number 31 car, who's in 27th position. Look at Jeff Green in the number 3, closing up on Nemechek. That's from 9th position, the black number 3, Jeff Green, and he's in a big fight in the points. Here's Dale Jarrett right in there as well.
Dale lost about 5 positions over there in turn 2. His car slipped up, and boy, a lot of them went by him. That's the reason we saw such a big scramble there going down the backstretch.
Dale Jarrett's 10th. Jeff Green is in 9th. 8th is Nemechek, and take a look at Bobby Labonte coming after Dale Jarrett. Ralph Chaheen can tell us more about this conflict.
Can a tire kit changer's number one tool is his air gun. A bad air gun on Bobby Labonte's last stop has sent Bobby deeper into the field. He is now back outside of the top 10. Fighting to get back inside of it.
Just made it. Just cranked it in there as he went underneath Dale Jarrett in the 44. And here comes David Green. He's beginning to exert some pressure. What a wide open race today, Ned. Here you've got Todd Bodine back in front. Young Glenn Allen Jr. up to second. Elton Sawyer into third. This is wide open all day.
Certainly there has not been a clear-cut favorite established yet, because we have had a lot of different drivers running up front, a lot of drivers with cars capable of winning this race. Dale Jarrett doesn't appear to be one of them because he's headed towards the back. But certainly there are a lot of good cars out there.
There you see Jimmy Spencer, who made his lap up earlier. He's back on the lead lap and moving back toward the front.
19th, Spencer in the white number 20. See Ricky Craven. Haven't heard much about him today. He's in 21st at the present time. So Todd Bodine, Glenn Allen, and now Kevin LePage back to third. Had a terrible pit stop, 25 seconds. He fights his way right back into this thing. There he goes for second.
Might have had a bad pit stop, but he got an awfully good race car.
Great race car, and he is driving the wheels off that thing. There's the interval between first and second. Kevin LePage going around Glenn Allen and picking up a spot. Getting himself second and going back after Todd Bodine for the lead. That interval, first to second, less than a second, about 56 one-hundredths of a second. That is some battle up in front. For the moment, Todd Bodine there, Kevin LePage, Glenn Allen, Elton Sawyer falling to fourth, and Mark Martin is in fifth. So here's LePage putting a lap on Dick Trickle. LePage started 10th, fell well back. He joined the Riddling Racing team about 7 or 8 events into the 1996 season. He It's his third season in Grand National. Here you see the 82. That's Todd Bodine, still very much a part of it. A note for our Spanish-speaking NASCAR fans, this broadcast is available on SAP in Miami, in Houston, Texas, Arlington, Texas, and Portland, Oregon. A whole different flavor to the event down here in Miami. Hope you're all going to enjoy it. SAP in Miami, Houston, Harlingen, Texas, Portland, Oregon. 83 laps are now complete. 124 miles down. Shaheen has an interested spectator out here right now in Glenn Allen's progress.
Well, Ken, that would be Glenn Allen Sr., who used to be his son's crew chief when he ran back in ASA. How's his son doing right now, Glenn?
Well, he's running third right now, or second. I don't know on the last lap, but we're doing real well. We came in early and made a pit stop. He didn't like the tires, so we took them off and then put some tires on early, but we haven't changed. We just gassed the last time, and everything seems to be okay.
Ken, this is the first lap Glenn has led in a Busch car, and when Glenn Allen Sr. isn't catching gas for his son now in the Busch Tour, he's the mayor of a little town just outside of Cincinnati.
The mayor better get a proclamation ready. That kid's having a terrific day.
And to know that he did not change tires the last time, that says a lot for the tire that Goodyear has brought here. A lot of staying power. Here you see Mark Martin looking to the inside. As they go off into turn three, look like Mark pulls it to the bottom. He will win the battle off turn three.
Snaps up third spot, Mark Martin.
We haven't seen a lot of side-by-side racing like that, especially people like Mark, who has tried to be so cautious, but he did carry him too deep going into turn three.
Oh, take a look at this three wide down the chute. Ooh. Mark Martin right there, Glenn Allen in the midst of it, and Jason Keller in that number 57.
Jason Keller was involved in that big accident earlier, made a lot of pit stops during that caution, but his car seems to be working well.
And he's up in fifth spot. Jason Keller having a very good day. Moving in on the leader. The leader, Todd Bodine, down the main straightaway. LePage in chase.
LePage has caught him. He was back, what, 10 or 12 car lengths? Now he is there.
Right there, right through the center of the corner. That's where Kevin LePage's car is so strong. He really gets a good run off that corner as he pulls to the inside of Todd Bodine. Mike Wallace in the Jeff Purvis car, a couple of laps down there, and Kevin LePage will take the lead going into turn three.
Second time today that Kevin LePage has put it up in front.
Oh, that is impressive.
His car's really strong right there, right through the center of the corner. And what that does, Ned, that lets him get a good run off, and it really helps him run down these long straightaways.
Makes the motor look awfully good. Of course, you've got to have a good motor to pull it off of there, but it makes it look even better, as you say, to get that momentum coming off the turn.
Plummeting down into turn number one and propelling that number 88 into the lead is LePage, then second Bodine, and you see Mark Martin and the rest of the field scooting through that first turn area. Down the back straightaway. That back stretch is about 20 feet higher than the front straightaway here. Ned, Larry, do you think that had anything to do with the five or six crashes that we saw early in the week, that there is a little bit of up in one, a little bit of down in two? You may be at the same RPM level, same braking spot, but it is just that tad different.
I don't know. A driver wouldn't notice it when he's out there going around the racetrack, but, you know, I guess he will.
There's so many
going
wrecks
uphill
there in
yeah,
three.
That's
and
true.
Big, terrible crashes.
And, you know, you mentioned that to me, Ken, so I did the thing that a good reporter does. I went down in that garage area this morning, and I asked some of the drivers, did they think that was an element? Half of them said, I didn't know it was higher. I didn't know the backstretch was higher, so I don't know if it's playing a role or not.
All right. Well, thanks for checking in. Here you see the 44 of Bobby Labonte back in that seventh spot. Let's go to Dick Berger.
Well, Ken, it's an interesting day for Kevin LePage, who earlier this year was basically out of a ride. He was almost completely out of racing. But about a third of the way through the season, he got hooked up with a team he's driving for today. This is only the 19th race with that team, but he's got eight top tens with him since joining, and they are are delighted with the car. It's a little loose going into the first turn, but he is making up his time. According to C.R. Miller, the crew chief, he is making up his time going in the third turn, and so they are going to leave it alone. It's hang on, grit your teeth in one, and pass him in turn three.
Jeff Neal in the 81 slowing down. Hope he can get back in. He's midway down the back straightaway trying to limp his way around back up in front. Here is LePage. And, you know, he's 13th in point with Terry Labonte just in front of him and not running today. Good run here could put him up in the top 10 for the year.
And you know, Ken, this is one of the Busch Grand National teams that's going to a two-car effort next year. Dennis Setzer will be Kevin LePage's teammate. So things really looking good for that team today.
They've already picked up another crew chief. C.R. Miller's going to be part of it. He'll probably be with LePage. Can't get over the fact that he had a 25-second pit stop, which is kind of a well, and he gets back in there and collects them.
Yeah, 25 seconds. Boy, back when I was driving race cars, we had 25 seconds on a two-tire change. But nowadays, if you get much over 20, well, then that gets to be long. But it really isn't that bad.
It's all tonight, starting at 7 Eastern, right here on CBS. We're at 96 laps. Into this dynamite Jiffy Lube 300. It's had everything, all kinds of lead changes, some great racing, only three cautions, one for a 10-car calamity in turn one, the other two for minor incidents, a little debris out here, Rodney Combs' car. Rodney's back on pit road another time. It's been on again, off again, Combs all afternoon, and there's your leader. From the Green Mountain State of Vermont, Kevin LePage out in front with Todd Bodine in second. There is Todd Bodine out of Chemung, New York in second. Mark Martin from Arkansas third. And Glenn Allen is having a great race. Take a look here.
Whoa, going three deep into turn one.
Chad Little right in the middle with the 44.
Bobby Labonte, here's Nemechek in there.
Fifth, Glenn sixth, Allen. And seventh, Ned.
Great racing back in the pack. And the reason you see that three abreast coming off of turn four and going into turn one, they pick up the draft. They're running fast enough on the straightaway here. When two cars get side by side, if there's a car behind them, boy, he gets a big open air situation there that he can just draft right on the inside. That's what we saw there.
Wow.
They're probably entering these corners running about 155, maybe close to 160 miles an hour. Of course, we're averaging in the mid-130s here around Homestead.
The points. Green by six at the present time. David Green in 12th. Lajoie has moved back to 25th. So Lajoie back in the lead lap is beginning to gain ground and reel David Green in another time. Had him when the race started by 33 points. Lost him, went more than 33 behind. A lap down. Now he's back six behind. Green leads, Lajoie second.
It is going to be an interesting situation right down to the checkered flag, it looks like.
And Mark Green, middle brother, on pit road. Comes in another time, unscheduled stop. Lap 99, coming down to the halfway mark in this race. Kevin LePage leading as we come to halfway with Todd Bodine right there slugging it out for the lead. We'll get that interval for you right now between first and second spot. You're at Homestead. NASCAR's Busch Grand National Series concluding its year right here in a great battle for the race and for the championship. And there's the interval as we come to halfway.
Kevin LePage at this point just run a flawless race. He just running the perfect line around this place.
Larry, I just clocked him a couple laps ago. He, in qualifying, he ran an elapsed time of 39.44 seconds. He just turned a lap of 39.45 here a moment ago, equal to his qualifying speed. I mean, that's unheard of. Most of the time, you lose a half a second or a second. And fans, when they qualified here on Friday, the sun was in and out behind the clouds. Don't know if he had the advantage of the cloud or not, but there are no clouds in the sky today. So he's just running out there in the hot weather and turning some tremendous laps.
Putting a lap on McLaughlin back in 30th position is Kevin LePage. We're halfway into the event. LePage leading, Todd Bodine in second, Mark Martin in third, Bobby Labonte up to fourth, Nemechek is fifth, Chad Little sixth, Glenn Allen seventh, and Shane Hall's in eighth. Green is in 12th. What's that position on Lajoie? 24th. 24th position, and the difference between first and second for the national championship, 3 points. 3 points. Look at Todd Bodine close in on the 88. Kevin LePage in this battle for the lead as they lap Hermie Sadler in 29th position, the number one car.
Hermie Sadler was one of those three drivers battling for the lead here a year ago when they were coming around for the white flag. Didn't quite make it back. But his car apparently not working as well today.
There you see Hermie Sadler and McLaughlin. Well back in this event. They are fighting for 29th position. Here's the battle for the lead. LePage, Bodine. A couple of northern drivers come into this Grand National Series. Bodine has won 9 Grand National races. LePage still looking for that first win. Mark Martin, CM number 60, coming by in third. A little further back in the field here. See the 85 of Shane Hall in that seventh position. Jason Keller in the 57 right there with him. Jeff Green. He's putting up a big fight in those points.
Really a good run for the young Shane Hall here today, moving into the top 10.
Unexpected story. Watching Kevin LePage trying to pull a major upset before some 65,000 race fans here in the greater Miami area, the Dade Metro Homestead Motorsports Complex, giving us a great race in its second outing for Grand National. 3 cautions to date. And speaking of Kevin LePage, all right, folks, if you want to win a trip halfway, Kevin LePage, Miami 300 sweepstakes coming up. Want to win a trip for two to the 1997 Busch Clash at Daytona and be the honorary starter for the race? Well, here's your chance. All you have to do, send a postcard with your name and address and age and the name of the halfway leader in today's race. Mailed to Miami 300 Sweepstakes, MRN Radio. That's box 2888, Daytona Beach, Florida. Give me that address again. Miami 300 Sweepstakes, MRN Radio, box 2888, Daytona Beach, Florida, 32115. Or you can enter on the CBS website there. Added touch for Kevin, huh?
Mm-hmm. Todd Bodine had pulled back up on him, but now he's pulling back away.
I think he did that in traffic, Larry. They caught some cars and were putting a lap on Hermie Sadler and a couple of other cars there, and I think that was the time that Bodine was able to make up that distance.
Hey, fellas, while we got 1 second, they got a little bit of stabilization in this race. That Busch Clash, first event in Daytona Speed Weeks for us on CBS, that's a tremendous field this year. Big number of cars have qualified, and all of them classed up.
A lot of number of cars, and we always approach it, Ken, that it's a good beginning test session for what's to come the following week in the Daytona 500.
Because you get 50 laps of hard racing there, and boy, you don't hold back in that one. I mean, you go out there and go at it from start to finish. And
about 15 minutes, you got it all. All right, let's go to Dick Bergman on pit road.
Well, did you ever buy a brand new car and anticipate the day you're first going to drive it and you think everything's going to be great and you drive it out of the showroom and it just doesn't feel right? Dick Trickle brought this brand new car to Homestead this weekend, thought everything was going to be great until he stepped on the gas for the first time, and it has been wicked loose ever since. This morning he said this thing has been trying to crash for 2 days. Well, they beat on the back of it with hammers, they pushed it out with porta powers, trying to aerodynamically adjust it. Trickle has just thrown the towel in. He says, rather than crash, I'll park it. Let them reskin it. We'll try it another day.
Probably a good idea.
Good thinking.
Not a bad idea. No. Just never got that car going at all this week. Had to use a provisional starting position and was trying to get in the top 10 in points here today at Miami.
Take a look at Kenny Wallace, number 8. That's his last ride in Grand National Racing. He's running back in 23rd position and is going to focus his entire season in 97 in Winston Cup Racing. And the interval for first place now begins to widen. Kevin LePage, 15 years, 16 years experience, used to drive for his dad for many years, owned a little service station up on the side of Lake Champlain, the Vermont side. He is really carrying the family colors in a big way here today over Todd Bodine and Mark Martin, second and third, respectively. 111 laps have been completed here this afternoon, 166 and a half miles with Ned Jarrett, the two-time Winston Cup champion, Larry McReynolds, who you know from his great work with Ernie Irvin this year and with a young driver named Dale Jarrett in the Winston Cup action. We're having a great time here at Homestead watching all this competition, which has been just phenomenal thus far, gentlemen. I can't recall a Grand National race that's been this exciting and had this many surprises.
Had some great racing, and yeah, the surprises, that makes it interesting. Kevin LePage, the car we're watching right there on television, has come to the front and has dominated here in the last 25 or 30 laps. Great race car he has, and he's doing a great job of driving.
Hey, Ned, how about this? National championship at this moment, tied. Green in 11th, Lajoie in 22nd. They're even in points. They're tied as we come to the halfway point of this event.
And I'm sure that fans wonder, well, if it ends in a tie, who would win the championship? Randy Lajoie would win the championship.
Most wins.
5-2.
Mm-hmm. Whoa, what a story. What a day. Beautiful day. Perfect weather. Ralph Sanchez ordered the whole thing up. There you see some of the 65,000 folks at this facility celebrating its second anniversary today with this NASCAR Busch Grand National race. A track. Isn't that a beautiful racetrack?
Beautiful.
Out there in the background, you see some of the fields. This is a big agricultural country. Raise a lot of potatoes down here. Think you're out on the end of Long Island. No, indeed. You're in South Florida, right on the edge of the Keys. A lot of things to do here. And if you don't want to race, don't want to watch the race, hey, just go in the infield. Have a little fun with one of these things. That's right. That's the infield.
Yeah. Could you do that in Connecticut right now, Ken?
Maybe in Connecticut, but up in Vermont, it might be a little tricky.
Oh, okay.
I think it's snow last night. But you can in the summer.
You know, in the middle of the summer.
One or two days. There you see the point as you look at the point battle, and we watch Kenny Wallace steaming along with that number 74, Randy Lajoie. You think about Randy Lajoie, and I think back to the 80s when they brought him down, the Snellman Industries folks out of Connecticut, and he had one of the worst wrecks we've ever seen. Came out of turn four and went feet first into the barrier about 185 miles an hour, end over end, side over side. We thought that was going to end his year, might have ended his career. Hey, he was back to track the next day. Here's the 48 on pit road, Randy Porter. And Randy Porter's day, I don't think, has been that much fun. Let's see where Randy Porter is showing up in our standings. He's well back out here today, 30th spot.
And Jeff Fuller coming into the pits as well right now. His car had really gone away on the racetrack. He was slipping and sliding all over, and so he fought it as long as he wanted to, I guess, and coming in. But now it doesn't look like they're going to change tires. They're just, he coasted into the pit, so Jeff Fuller.
Going under the hood. Most of these leaders pitted about lap 65, so we're at lap 117 now, about 20 laps from now. We're going to probably see the leaders on pit road, and I guess the interesting part to watch, that could be their final pit stop should this thing go green, and it certainly looks like it's being content to stay green right now. The key will it be two tires, will it be four tires? So we got so many stories unfolding here besides the championship battle. As can Kevin LePage keep this pace up, and can his car stay here the rest of this day?
Very good point. Be interesting to see how it plays out. Randy Lajoie, another almost close call coming off of turn four. Something happened to Ted Christopher's car. He was up high, and Lajoie had to make a very evasive move coming off the turn, but everything was okay. He didn't hit anything.
There's that Christopher number 31 you were just talking about, Ned.
Yep.
He looks like he's in big trouble.
Yep, evidently the engine has blown up or giving some problems on it, and that happened right in front of Randy Lajoie coming off of turn four when it first went away on him.
And they were running for position. Christopher in his 31 was in 21st, and Lajoie was right up his tailpipe in 22nd when Christopher's engine calved. Well, we got a little bump we can show you too. Take a look at this. There's Lajoie.
Okay, there you see the 31 get out of shape, and boy, Lajoie made a good move to get down on the inside. That's closer than you might have thought. It was closer than I thought it was when I looked down and saw it.
Another angle. Boy, that's how close he ducked the bullet. He almost got himself scalped there, Lajoie. And with that move, Lajoie is back in front for the national championship by 3 points.
But he had to be thinking, oh, no, not again. Yeah. No place to go. But fortunately, he got down to the bottom of the racetrack. And I'm sure the smoke that we saw from the Ted Christopher car was probably a tire rubbing where he went up and brushed the outside wall.
David Green is up to 11th, Lajoie to 21st. Christopher on pit road. Kevin LePage is leading. Todd Bodine is in second. We may be on our way to an upset, but there may be pit stops in the next 7 laps. And if Kevin LePage has one as miserable as his first, he's going to be in trouble. Let's go to Ralph Shaheen.
Ken, John Fabian is the crew chief for Todd Bodine. Now, what is your pit strategy? You're running in second right now.
Well, it's a little bit tight right now, tight off the corner, so we're going to add a little air to both rear tires.
Guy.
Well, there you see the 82, Todd Bodine in second spot.
So that's about 13 or 14 laps before pit stops, according to him.
Hmm. We'll take a quick break. Lap 121. Some of the retirees. Hutto in that first big crash that took Sensor and Benson and Cope and Rich and Rodney Combs has finally called it a day. Larry Pearson's engine. Biffle from Oregon, he's gone. Dick Trickle parked his number 64. And Neil in the 81 had an engine expire. At the beautiful Homestead Metrodade Racetrack, Florida, we're watching one of the best races we've seen in years. Kevin LePage and Todd Bodine continue to duke it out up in front. And the battle for the national championship, unbelievable. It has seesawed back and forth from the very outset of today's 300-mile, 200-lap race. And at the moment, by a mere 3 points. New England's Randy Lajoie is leading the great David Green out of Owensboro, Kentucky. Two fine race drivers. There is David Green, Buzz McCall's number 95, saying sayonara to this series at the end of this event. They're now running in 11th spot. And there is Lajoie. Lajoie, who went a lap down, is now to 20th, and he's continuing to pick up points. Now it's a 6-point interval as he moved from 21st to 20th and got by Kenny Wallace. Randy Lajoie is back in command of the Busch Grand National Series for 1996 and the number one spot at the head table here in Miami on Monday night. 6 the difference, men.
Boy, both of them want to be at that, the star of that Busch banquet tomorrow night. While we were doing some of the other things that we've been doing, we saw Bobby Labonte a good while ago. He, after the pit stop, he was about 15th or 16th. He has quietly worked his way up to third place. So Bobby Labonte is on the move now. Of course, LePage still leads. Todd Bodine still second, but Bobby Labonte is gaining on them. There's LePage. And Mark Martin still running fourth. Joe Nemechek in fifth.
Joe Nemechek's race cam here for you. Continues his own quest out here today in the Bell South Mobility car, number 87. Started in position number 5, and that's right where he is as we come around to complete 130 laps, this time 195 miles.
Joe running in the 5th position. He is about 9 to 10 seconds behind the leader, Kevin LePage. And I keep talking about this pit strategy coming up. Dale Jarrett makes a pit stop.
Look at this. There's Dale Jarrett in.
He's the first of those that were on the lead lap to come into the pits. Tim Fedor made a pit stop a little while ago.
24 seconds, and he's back out.
Dale Jarrett getting what he hopes to be his last set of tires as we have 70 laps to go. And again, the key here is within the next 8 to 10 laps, these leaders are going to be on pit road. We're still clocking the leader, Ned, and he's still running laps as quick as he qualified and have got 60 to 65 laps on these tires. So the question's going to be, and as a Winston Cup crew chief with a tire this good, we do this a lot. It's going to be a little bit of monkey see, monkey do. Somebody's going to roll the dice.
Looks to me like we've got a leader coming out of pit road. Slowing down, here comes Kevin LePage in. This will be his pit stop. It's coming in the 131st lap. LePage down to what, 45 miles an hour today or 65?
45 miles an hour today.
Here's Dick Bergren.
Well, this may be the most important pit stop of Kevin LePage's entire career. If they can cut a good one here, he will retain a good shot to win this race. Never won one of these Grand National races. Second in Michigan, his best ever. The crew has been telling each other, calm down, let's do it right. They're starting to go over the wall a little bit early. Here comes LePage. LePage now in. Nice, slow, gentle stop. Bobby, Ricky Turner is on the rear tires. Jenny Shabari is on the front. C.R. Miller, the crew chief, he's your jack man. Art Graham is doing the gas. LePage inched forward just a tiny little bit. It's going to be a four-tire stop for LePage. They've got the fuel in. Joe Nemechek comes in front of him. LePage will have no problem getting out of his pit. He is not blocked in. It is a slow pit stop. Again, 25-60, slow pit stop again for LePage. They needed a fast one and didn't get it.
Nemechek on pit road. They're going all the way around on the number 87, the Bell South Mobility car.
Ricky Craven is in. Jason Keller coming down pit road. Phil Parsons is in.
They're saying that Nemechek had to take a little shot of ether in the carburetor to get that thing fired and run out of gas. And here comes Todd Bodine. Todd Bodine now moving in. There's a car out of control.
That's Todd Bodine. He hit pit road running too fast, and he's going to have to go all the way back around. He completely missed the entrance to pit road. That is going to cost Todd Bodine.
Oh, man, it will. It'll cost him at least.
Someone else has missed as well.
Well, I think the others thought there might be a caution, and the spotters probably told Jeff Green had come in, and he just went right on back out on the racetrack, didn't even come down pit road. But the spotter probably told him, hey, there might be a caution. There's a spin up here. But Todd Bodine was not out on the racetrack. He got his car going again, come on around. So, you know, there's no need for a caution. So that's going to cost Jeff Green as well.
It did. Yeah, because you enter pit road way up by turn three. You begin to slow down and get it, the whoa, to come around four on that special lane into the pits.
And they can run as fast as they can on this access road. The pit road speed actually don't start to the first pit box, which is about right there. That's where they have to start maintaining that 45 miles per hour.
And he nearly planked the end of that wall with his number 82. That was close. Now he's in. It cost him a lot of time. Looks like it's going to cost him a lap. Ralph Shaheen.
Crew Chief John Fabian told me, Ken, that Todd said there was no good excuse for him missing pit road. He just flat missed it. John now working to Jack. His brother changing the rear tires. This is truly a family affair on this crew. They've got the right side on. His brother, Jeff Fabian, is going to be marrying the daughter of the gas man in about 2 weeks. The crew going to work on this car, trying to get him in and out as quick as they can. 28.7 seconds for Todd Bodine.
We don't want you to miss anything, folks. Get all the social news as well as the pit stops here.
That's a great call. We got it all in.
David Green is in fourth. Randy Lajoie in sixth as these pit stops continue. After we finish the pit stop, we'll sort it out and give you a better overview of where they stand.
Really close call there on pit road as Glenn Allen Jr. pulled out and Bobby Hamilton was coming down pit road. Real close call for those two cars.
Bobby Labonte, who had inherited the lead, now comes onto pit road. I think that's going to give it back to Mark Martin. Here's Bobby Labonte coming in. Set on the pole for this race at 139 miles an hour.
Ned, it looks like pretty much all the teams have elected to put on four tires with hopes that will be their last set of tires of the day.
Let's go to Ralph Shaheen.
Well, they're going to work on the left side of the car now. Bobby Labonte's shell machine. The gas is in. One can is done. Wiping up the front grill. They gave him something to drink. The stop is completed. 21.2. A very good stop for Bobby Labonte.
One win this year. That at Nashville for Bobby Labonte in Grand National Racing. And he brings the number 44 back up to speed. Eases it down. Now he puts it through the gears. Comes up on that exit road. That'll bring him back onto the track just out of turn two. Mark Martin may be coming in next. He has inherited the lead. Elliott Sattler has gone to second. David Green third. LaJoy fourth. And it looks like there is an expectation that Mark Martin is coming in.
He's on pit road. He's on the entrance to pit road right now, Tim.
Six-time winner this year. Has run just 13 races and leads more laps than any one of the series. This is the 26th race. He's only run half of them. And knocking on the door, as was Terry Labonte, to be right up among the top 10. Phenomenal story by Mark Martin this year. Dick Bergren following the story of Mark Martin.
Ken, it is a phenomenal story. They originally were going to just take two tires, but they looked down the pit road, they saw everybody else taking four, and at the very last minute, Steve Meehl put up four fingers, indication to take four tires. They've got a chassis adjuster in the back of the car. They're going to try to tighten it up a little bit. One round, two rounds, that's it. Going to take a full load of fuel, and that'll be it. Skip Elder is doing the front tires. Jeff Troxler is on the jack. He's got the left side up now. Ben Leslie, Tracy's brother, he's on the back. Tom McGee, he is on the fuel, and he is all done with his work. Trouble on the left front. They're having a hard time with the left front. Bad pit stop. 24 seconds plus for Mark Martin. That left front tire change is going to hurt him.
Back underway, Mark Martin, Arkansas's fearless race driver. Here's David Green now on pit road.
And Lajoie right behind him.
So the champions are both on pit road. Let's see, they're both there, 95 and 74. They're nose to tail coming down pit road as they fight for the national championship. There they are, making their pit stop at 139, working lap 140 as they both come in.
They was the last of the leaders to come in.
Here's Dick Berggren.
Well, Green got to his stall first. He led down pit road, and as a result, he's got a bit of a head start. On the other hand, Lajoie is a little bit further down pit road. These crews both know how important it is to get their guy out without problems. Green is going to make it a two-tire stop. Lajoie does too. Off and running, and Lajoie is going to be Green out of the pits. Both of them took just two.
And Todd Bodine has slowed on the racetrack.
Dramatically came out.
I think, Ken, what he did, he just got very high coming off of turn four, almost lost it, and which made him go slow down the front straightaway here.
Randy Lajoie back in command of the Busch Grand National Series as we decide the championship today. CBS Sports coverage of the Jiffy Lube Miami 300 continues after this message and a word from your local star. Back at Homestead, Florida, another time. And we're at lap 143 with Bobby Labonte after this round of pit stops, inheriting first spot. Great pit stop by him and a four-tire change. Mark Martin comes up to second, and he's back several seconds, like seven. Then in third is Chad Little, and Kevin LePage is in fourth, with Elliott Sadler having a terrific day in fifth, and Shane Hall in sixth. Randy Lajoie, seventh. Jeff Green, eighth, and Jimmy Spencer. Coming up, Las Vegas. And a couple of folks standing by to tell you what you're going to be seeing out there today. Buddy Baker and Mike Joy at that great new facility in Vegas.
Ken, it's a beautiful new racetrack. It's the fastest the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series has ever run on. It's their richest purse and their longest race ever. It's the final event of the season, and three drivers are vying for the championship. Buddy Baker, Ron Hornaday comes in here with a 72-point lead.
Boy, he wished it was 172. He's very nervous. You can see it in his face. Right now, this is a big, big championship for Ron Hornaday, and he is really focused on today's race.
Mike Skinner is a lot more relaxed. Skinner is the defending series champion, and he'll move up to Winston Cup Racing next year. He'd like to put that second title in his pocket before he goes. And what about the man who could be the spoiler, Jack Sprague?
Well, Jack Sprague is going to finish third if everything goes wrong. He can only advance, so he's going to let her fly today.
There'll be action aplenty coming up here shortly in Las Vegas for the Truck Series race. Let's go back to South Florida and Ken Squire.
Hey, before you go, Mike, how nervous are those guys going this quick?
I think some of them are a little nervous. We've got some Winston Cup drivers here, five Daytona 500 winners. But, Buddy, some of these drivers, I think, are a little nervous about the speed.
Well, a lot of them are really what you call short track aces, and they're on a major speedway out here, no doubt about it. 180 miles an hour down the straightaway. Hey, a lot of them are uncomfortable.
Well, that's going to be a lot of fun to watch. I can't wait to see it. Those trucks have put on such a great show this year. And that championship round will be decided this afternoon right here on CBS. We're trying to decide the Grand National title at this moment. And the battle is continuing between David Green and Randy Lajoie. Lajoie now into seventh spot, and David Green further back in 13th. On the track itself, we've got a battle for second spot.
Kevin LePage takes it, just motors right around Mark Martin. Remember, Kevin Page didn't have a very good pit stop, got back behind both Bobby Labonte and Chad Little and the Mark Martin car. Now he has passed all of them but Bobby Labonte.
That Bobby Labonte pit stop is what it's all about. He made a flawless pit stop. Four tire, you talk about teamwork. McReynolds, those guys headed down.
They really did it. You know, we talked about it prior to those pit stops. That pit stop could be a big part of the outcome of this event is how quick these crews could get these cars in and out of pit road.
Right now, Bobby Labonte is drawing away with Kevin LePage in second. It's about 8 seconds between first and second. Now we're showing 100. 48 laps complete, 222 miles down at Homestead. Watching this race to decide the final winner in the Grand National Series. It's going to be expanded to more races. They're going back across to Mississippi next year. This series really taking on a life of its own, and watching this great championship battle. Seesaw affair for the title, reminiscent of Dale Earnhardt's first title drive back in 1980. Remember Earnhardt falling a lap behind early at Ontario, California, made it up, came from behind, and beat Cale Yarborough by 19 points. That was in 1980 for the crown. But let's go to Ralph Shaheen.
Ken, one of the things that's interesting to note about Bobby Labonte is he is one of the few drivers in the field who has never raced at this racetrack. Yes, he was here last year, but all he did was qualify the car for older brother Terry. And as you remember, he also crashed the car last year while trying to qualify a car for older brother Terry. So a very tricky racetrack, and Bobby Labonte coming to grips with it without a lot of laps on it.
Bobby Labonte having a great day. Terry Labonte looking better, but his hand, we got a chance to see it the other day after he broke right behind the index finger on the wrist. Looks like something out of Halloween. No fun at all as he gets ready for his last race at Phoenix next week. Two titles, one in Grand National Racing, one in their new truck series out in Vegas coming up. Long time since they've been in Vegas. October 1955 had a Winston Cup race out there. And before it was over, Norm Nelson and Chrysler took it home. Well, today it's going to be a truck. It could be Hornaday. Could be Reffner, the guy on the pole. Mike Skinner. Darrell Walter, Bill Elliott, A.J. Foyt. Who knows? Be with us to find out. Anyway, at 155 of 200 laps complete, here's your leader at Homestead, Florida. Bobby Labonte with Kevin LePage, about 7 seconds back in second. Mark Martin in third, and Chad Little in fourth. I said Phoenix a moment ago. Phoenix was last week. Atlanta is next week. Phoenix was a great race, and what an incredible performance by Terry Labonte there. Broken hand and all, Ned. That run that he made for third spot tells you the kind of guy that Terry Labonte is.
He is tough, there's no doubt about it. But that lead that Bobby Labonte had is beginning to shrink a little bit. It was over 8 seconds, then it was over 7 seconds. Now it's down to, I think, about 5.5 seconds or something like that. So Kevin LePage is on the move.
Time to get it done. Hey, Glenn Allen has lost some laps. Glenn Allen has fallen back. He is being shown in 22nd position. And Todd Bodine, who was running so well, back in 15th. Ralph Shaheen can tell us more on both of those stories.
Well, Glenn Allen Jr. went a little too fast down pit road. There is a speed limit of 45 miles an hour. During his last pit stop, he went over that. He was black flag brought in. He is now down one lap. And Todd Bodine, the crew does not know why the car got loose on the racetrack. They have lost radio contact, so they have no idea what the problem was, but he seems to be okay at this point.
Kevin LePage has now closed it down to 5 seconds. He has such a great race car. There's Martin running in third place.
Chad Little up to fourth. Elliott Sadler for fifth.
Saw Hermie Sadler in the picture there. Hermie is back in 24th position. He's a couple laps down.
Elliott's his younger brother. Shane Hall is in sixth. Lajoie now to seventh. Randy Lajoie, what a comeback he has made in this race. Oh, we've got one in trouble. Caution's out. Looks like Bodine, doesn't it? See, it's 85.
Shane Hall
running in sixth spot.
The caution is out.
In trouble. Fourth caution of the day.
Comes on lap 158, so 42 laps to go. Be interesting now. I got to believe, Ned, that most of the leaders that took those four tires on, they probably will stay out here. But we've got the championship contenders, David Green and Randy Lajoie, that's sitting there with just two fresh tires. They have not put on tires since about lap 68, so it'll be interesting to see what they do. But they're racing each other.
Well, you know, one thing that I've been clocking a lot of different cars since they made that pit stop, Kevin LePage, none of them were running as fast since they put on new tires as they were before they made those pit stops.
Shane Hall clambering out of the car. He's okay.
So those crew chiefs have got to be looking at those lap times and say, hey, wait a minute. Either the set of tires that they put on were not matched quite as well, or something has happened, and maybe they'll want to get those off. But I haven't talked to anybody that was running as fast as they were before. Kevin LePage was beginning to there, but he had not turned the fast laps that he had right before he pitted.
And you know what will happen a lot of times, Ned, on a green flag stop, even when you put four tires on? When you put them on under caution, these guys drop the air pressures down. That's to keep the air pressure from building up so far. They have a few pace laps before they go back to racing to get those tires some heat in them before they go back to racing. When you come and you pit under green, you go straight back to the racetrack, you go straight back to racing, and you abuse those tires a little bit early. So that sometimes is the difference between running fast after a green flag stop and running fast after a caution.
Very good point. Well, Bobby Labonte is not coming in.
Let's see who's going to take the gamble. We have, what, 18, 19 cars in that lead lap?
And that's a big key right there, track position. You've got that many cars on the lead lap, even with about 41 laps to go. You're at the front of the pack. You can't afford to come in and some of those guys back in the back stay out.
But some of the back in the back are coming in, which is smart, because they don't really have that much to lose.
Exactly.
Ricky Craven a lap down. In the 18th position, just overwhelmed by Bobby Labonte in the last couple of laps.
Todd Bodine on pit road, Jason Keller, Kenny Wallace, Jeff Green, Elton Sawyer, all of these guys are running at the back of the pack. They come in for pit service here on this caution, lap 160.
Just 40 to go. 60 miles left in this one.
Phil Parsons coming out of the pits, Kyle Petty.
Phil Parsons, ready to roll. Car 10, channel lock car. Having a pretty good day, 16th position, still in that lead lap.
And he's one of those drivers in the top 10 in the points.
Make a big difference for him today, that battle in the top 10. The first Grand National race of 1997. Is right here on CBS, where you're seeing the grand finale of 96. Saturday, February 15th. Don't miss the Goodies 300 from the Daytona Speedway. Saturday, February 15th at high noon on CBS. Last year it was Steve Grissom. Year before, Dale Jarrett. Who knows? It's a great race from beginning to end. The day before the Great American Race. 17 cars in the lead lap. 32 cars remain on the track of the 43 that started. We're at lap 162. 200 laps make the distance of 300 miles. So as we get down to it, Ned, after this stop with 57 to go, what are we going to see from here?
Well, certainly it tightens the field up a lot. Kevin LePage was gaining on Bobby Labonte before the caution came out, so that's going to put him right there with him. So I expect we'll see him going to the front pretty quickly. But Bobby Labonte apparently was pleased with the way his car was running and handling at that time. He didn't want to give up that track position, so he stayed out there, as all the front runners did. And as we pointed out, it seemed like the longer they run, the better those things get. I'll tell you, Goodyear does have a great tire here for him today.
Larry, before this started, we heard David Green say, last 50 laps, 200 lap race, first 150, we're going to be safe, keep the fenders on, last 50 will tell the story. We better get out of Dick Bergen for a moment.
Yeah, I guess it's a huge story in Randy LaJoie's pit. Steve Bird, what is going on down here?
We're just a little close on gas. I think we got it. You know, we just asked Jimmy for a push for a lap, you know. But I guess we'll make it, you know. And I know there's a big paddy up in Lawrence, Mass. At Henry J's, so we're going for it, guys.
How close is this deal, Steve?
We're within a lap, I think. I hope.
They didn't get enough gas in it on that last stop, Ken Squire. They are fighting their fingernails in Randy LaJoie's pit. The championship hangs in the balance.
And finally, for once, someone is asking for Jimmy Spencer to take care of him from the back end of the car. Never heard that one before. Thank you, Jim. LaJoie up by 45 points for the national title, and if he runs out of gas, what, 32 cars left out here?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that would not be good.
That would not be good at all.
I'm glad Steve Bird explained that a little closer, because I knew fuel mileage-wise, he should have been able to make it based on when he pit, but it sounds like they just did not get the car full.
Well, that adds another little ingredient.
Or are they playing dramatics with their competitor here, you think?
Do you think they'd let Jimmy Spencer run into him, or they didn't need to?
Well, no, I guess that pretty well tells that story.
Oh, brother.
There
You see the cars weaving. They've got these hot tires on there trying to get that rubber that's built up on them off as they go back to racing.
Dick Bergren.
The 74 guys are definitely not playing cat and mouse with David Green's crew. We got tipped off to this fuel thing by listening to Green's radio transmissions. They know all about it. They know the 74 has a problem.
All right.
Easy.
Good work.
Down two. Number 11 dives right in front. Tracy Leslie trying to make up a lap. Field down into the first turn. We're back under Green, working the 165th lap. Always a little tricky when you bring him back up, getting through a little bit of the dust from Shane Hall. Three wide into the back straightaway.
Was that the 99 car of Glenn Allen getting back into the lead lap? Remember, he lost a lap when he got penalized for going too fast down pit road.
Bobby Labonte stays first. Kevin LePage right there. Mark Martin for third. Chad Little fourth. Elliott Sadler and Randy Lajoie back there squabbling for fifth. Can Bobby Labonte sustain this drive? We've seen LePage time after time seem to have the power to come off these caution periods within three or four laps to make a stab at first place.
Elliott Sadler has just moved around Chad Little, and here comes Randy Lajoie. He has moved around and taken over the fifth position. The Elliott Sadler car goes into fourth. Lajoie now up to fifth, dropping Chad Little back to sixth.
I think the question often is asked, and now that we're here, would Lajoie try and win this race? Lajoie had said before, if I can get to the last 50 laps, I'll go for it. Don't think for a moment I won't. Then I wonder if they're having a little fuel situation here, if he may be a little more cautious.
Well, I think Randy's up there racing with guys now that he's very comfortable with racing with, that he knows is not going to make a bad move here. And he's got David Green behind him, so he's definitely running right now like he's going after to win this race.
There you see the leader, Bobby Labonte, of the race. The leader of the series, Randy Lajoie, is just four spots behind him in fifth.
Bobby's moved back around Glenn Allen Jr. to put him another lap down.
Bobby Labonte, the 1991 Busch Grand National Champion, has this race, but he doesn't have a very firm grip on it. And there you saw the 74 closing up on Elliott Sadler. That's the younger brother of Hermie Sadler, and what a race he's put on.
Now, we've talked about Kevin LePage, we've talked about Bobby Labonte, but that number 60 car, Mark Martin, he's not out of this thing either. His tires is getting some laps on him, and he looks like he may be getting ready to make his charge as well.
He's just been sitting there racing, riding, biding his time. And, you're right, Larry, he might be fixing to make a move, but I don't know about that 88 car, Kevin LePage, if anybody has anything for him. He's running second right now, but he is about to reel in Bobby Labonte.
Meanwhile, up in front, Labonte with that slim lead. Remember when he ran and won the championship in 91, fought with Kenny Wallace over and over again, four times took the lead over the season, four times Labonte answered and took it back, won the championship just barely over Wallace. Let's look further back in the field, Phil Parsons, see how he's doing back here. He's up to 12th position, started 33rd. The channel lock car having a very good run today. David Green in a bunch of traffic, trying to get this sorted out.
He's running in the top 10. He's been shown in 10th place right now.
Kyle Petty just in front, Todd Bodine just behind. There you see the 82. There is the points battle. There you see Lajoie, he's in fifth. David Green back there in 10th. And that number 29, it's hugging the back end of Lajoie. That would be Sadler if they continue their war. Lajoie up to fourth, and it is a 54-point lead. 30 laps to go. But the big issue here that Dick Bergman brought forth, the big issue, fuel. They didn't get a full tank load the last time they brought number 74 in. And it is so critical, they asked Jimmy Spencer if he would help them hitchhike him around for a lap, which he did, mile and a half. that's figuring it pretty close. Here's Kyle Petty in the 49, just in front of David Green. Ninth and 10th. Getting good, don't go away, and we've got a great one coming up in Vegas. Battle for the lead. Down the main straightaway, Kevin LePage has made it up on Bobby Labonte. We're at lap 176, and Kevin LePage is going for the lead into turn number one. Shelburne, Vermont's Kevin LePage puts the number 88 back in front of Corpus Christi, Texas's Texas Terry Labonte second. That's Bobby, the younger brother. And what a show these guys have put on over the last 20 laps.
Man, I can't believe the speed that they're running. The last lap, Bobby Labonte ran a 39.17. He qualified at 39.08. And yet was getting passed.
That's what the scary part about it. He ran that fast and got passed for the lead.
Down the chute.
LePage is fast.
LePage looking for his first Grand National victory. Paced himself well. Pit stops didn't help him. He's done it all on the racetrack today. Bobby Labonte back to second. Mark Martin in third. Randy Lajoie, as we get to the end of the race, has made up a lap and now runs in fourth.
That is a remarkable effort. Really, you've got to hand it to him. He's winning the championship in championship style.
Going out there and racing it out in the final laps. Here's Dick Berger.
I'm sitting on the garage floor with Steve Beal, and the two of us are looking up at a television set that's mounted on the wall here. Mark Martin, Steve's driver, has dropped back a little. What's happening, Mark?
Steve, we don't talk to Mark a lot when there's 25 to go like this. He's racing off a hard, so we just thought we'd come in here and take advantage of the shade, watch race on TV for once. It seems like we're always at him, in him, and we never get a chance to sit and watch him.
You got any idea at all as to what's going on with his race car?
It's not driving as good as it might. It's a little loose to start, and we put some stickers on the ride hoping it would tighten it up. It didn't really come in like we'd hoped. We may have just been a little bit off on the setup. Cars run good. These Busch guys have done a tremendous job all year, and it's kind of neat to come here to the last race of the year, watch the points race, and watch a little TV race.
Good race, isn't it?
It's a great race.
1 6/10 seconds from that second-place car, Bobby Labonte, back to the third-place car, Mark Martin. In 13 1996 starts, Mark Martin, in that number 60, has led 927 of 2,300 laps. Lajoie is second, and he's run about 800 laps.
Ken, I want to emphasize that speed again. Kevin LePage on his last lap turning at 39.06. Remember, the qualifying record that Bobby Labonte set here in seconds was 39.08. He's running faster than they qualified. I mean, that's unheard of, really.
There he is, Kevin LePage in front. He's pulled himself to second place. Twice this season, he knocked on the door, dominated, had a great run at Rockingham. Didn't work out that day, but this day, wow.
Ken, I would say with 21 laps to go, as good a car as he's got right here, he just needs to be smooth. He needs to be careful with the lap cars and just try to watch these laps wind down.
Now look at Ricky Craven. Ricky just moves over, lets him go, doesn't race him down into that corner. That was real gentleman.
They used to race each other a lot up in northern New England.
And I'm sure he'd love to see his buddy come home the winner. He knows how much it means.
With him going by Ricky Craven, he has a full straightaway in front of him, a clean racetrack right now.
20 to go. Bobby Labonte. Texas Terry's little brother is really having a run. But Kevin LePage is just that much faster here today. Martin in third, Nemechek in fourth, Lajoie to fifth, Elliott Sadler sixth, and Jimmy Spencer, and they're chasing. Vermont's Kevin LePage on his way to what looks to be his first Grand National victory. Next time by, we'll be down to 15 laps to go. And the battle for the championship, running in fifth spot, is Randy Lajoie. David Green dominated most of the season in his quest for a second national crown. And then that terrible crash at Charlotte, knocked unconscious, the rookie Darrell Lanigan spinning, hitting the wall, bouncing to the bottom of the track. David getting collected, and then slid sideways down the track into Shane Hall. Had to be cut out of his car. That was the turning point, that hard hit in turn three at Charlotte for David Green and Buzz McCall. But they have fought back here today. They went back into the lead. Now they're looking up from second position again. Bobby LaBonte. Labonte continues to have a good ride. He's in second place. Not as good as Kevin LePage, but good enough for second. Ralph Shaheen can tell us more.
Well, Kenny's still trying to catch him. Brian Fraser's a screw chief. Can you get Kevin LePage? Do you have enough horsepower for
him? Don't look. Right now, we're doing about all we can do. He's running about a tenth quicker per lap than we're running right now, and we're running only a tenth off of what we qualified. So this is a really fast race pace. If he can keep this pace up right now, I don't think we've got anything for him, but we don't know what Bobby's got left in, up his sleeve either, so we're going to do our best and see what we can do.
Well, that last lap, Bobby Labonte gained a little bit on Kevin LePage. Don't know if Kevin slipped a little bit or what, but Bobby Labonte gained about 0.2 seconds on him.
Joe Nemechek is back into fourth. Remember when Joe Nemechek led Bobby Labonte by 3 points going to that last race? Labonte won the race, but Nemechek finished sixth in the race and won the title. It was a 3-point margin beside the championship there. Here is Joe Nemechek. That's fourth position. Lajoie is behind him in fifth. And there you see Randy Lajoie in that number 74.
Now he's moved back to sixth, the 29 car of Elliott Sadler just passed him, and Sadler has moved up into the fifth position.
You know, Ned, I want to talk about, and I don't want to be an armchair quarterback sitting up here in the booth, but I want to talk about Lajoie and maybe Steve Bird's strategy here. You know, there's 12 laps to go. He's about 4 seconds. Forget the positions. He's 4 seconds ahead of David Green. If they are that close on fuel, if I'm Steve Bird, what I'm saying is get that carburetor closed. Back off a little early, getting in the corner. Get back to it a little bit late. You can buy a lap of fuel easily at a track of this size, but you've got to close the carburetor to do it.
And closing that carburetor means easing off before you get into the turn. Don't use as much brakes, and also easing onto the accelerator coming out of the turn.
It not just jumping back into it. The phrase I have, Dale will tell you, Ernie will tell you, is keep those butterflies closed.
10 laps to go. Leader, LePage. Second, Labonte. Third, Martin. Closing ever tighter together. LePage's crew looking on.
Keeping their fingers crossed.
Yeah, keeping their fingers crossed. Hoping that they're getting that much closer to their first win with this bright young star of Grand National Racing.
Now look at the right of your screen. Mark Martin is moving in on Bobby Labonte. See how close he has moved into him there.
He's definitely starting to close on Bobby.
Mark might have decided, well, it's time to go, guys. And it is. If you got anything left, it's time to let it all hang out.
Overview, Ned. I mean, we were here last year, 13 cautions in this race. They've certainly learned a lot, and they gave this race track such great respect.
Yeah, they did, and I think the things that we've seen happen in the days leading up to this race has made them gain even more respect for this racetrack, and as a result, it's been a much cleaner race than we expected, and I'm glad for it.
Jimmy Spencer said this morning in the Miami Herald, I don't think there is any track that we have more respect for, and they noted that might have meant feared, but he said that includes even Darling.
Yeah,
and that really does mean respect.
It sure does. He told me that Friday afternoon that he respected it more than Darlington, and every race driver respects Darlington.
It's a track where that wall can just leap out and grab you like it has a claw, and it has done it time and time again for 2 days, but today these drivers have put on a phenomenal show for these 65,000 people at the second Grand National Race in Homestead, Florida, down here in Dade Metro. And are these people in Homestead proud? This is the track that grew like the Phoenix out of Hurricane Andrew.
Labonte picked up another car.
Lajoie is dropping back, and that may be a conservation move.
Could be.
Can't believe he's...
Well, it's smart to conserve that fuel.
Think back to 1984 when Randy Lajoie came to Daytona at 125-mile, wound up in the hospital and that spectacular crash. Here's Ralph Shaheen.
Well, Steve Burr talking things over with one of his crew members, Bubba, over here.
see if we can sneak in on this conversation with Buddha. Steve, is this a move you did on purpose to let him back up a little bit?
Yeah, we just backpedaling here a little bit. We're good, you know. We got to look at the big picture here, and we got to be safe.
Do you feel good about it now? Are you at a point where you think you can wrap it up?
Not really. I don't know if we got enough gas.
Fingers crossed, legs crossed, everything crossed down here in this pit.
When he is in some heavy traffic, ooh, and here comes David Green coming up there. Wow, look at him, three abreast, and David Green just split him right in the middle.
Five laps to go. David Green giving it everything he's got. He is one exciting race driver to watch. What a great addition he will be in Winston Cup with that team. Randy Lajoie says, hey, I'm happy. I found my place. Love Grand National.
This makes a pretty big statement about the 1996 season. Here we are, five laps from the end of the season. Here your two championship contenders are running right together. Mm-hmm.
And out in front, a newcomer. LePage there, Bobby Labonte, Mark Martin. And can you imagine, with five to go, that Kevin LePage is leading these Winston Cup stars? We were talking before about, to get around this track, this would be the track that would favor those with the experience and the knowledge of tracks and have run all the various tracks, including Indianapolis, which is configured like this, except it's 2.5 and this is a mile and a half. And here is Kevin LePage, just on the cusp of winning his very first Grand National event.
And he will deserve it if he gets it, because he has run as hard as that car would go all day long. Got behind a couple of times on pit stops, but nevertheless fought his way back to the front every time.
LaJoy's pits.
Down on their knees. The leaders are going to come up on some traffic here before this thing is over.
Kevin LePage in his 69th Grand National start.
Mark Martin going for it for second.
Has it. Going into one. Mark Martin comes up to second place.
Kevin LePage did get caught behind the lap car going into turn one. He hopes he'll get by him before he goes into turn three. He needs to very badly if he possibly can.
Now you see the interval back to the 60. About nine car lengths, and Mark Martin is coming.
More lap traffic for Kevin to contend with.
He got by both of those. He got into that turn ahead of the Randy Porter car, so that was a big, big break for him. Now Martin's caught up behind him coming off of turn four. Bobby Labonte's going to try to make a pass again. That was a big break for Kevin LePage,
big
getting into turn three ahead of the 48 car. Martin still hasn't passed him.
That could make the difference. That move right there with Porter as the pawn.
Mark Martin will tell you after the race that killed his momentum. Not much of a chance after that to catch up.
But he's got to hold. Now he's got to race defensively because it's Bobby Labonte back on him another time. Going back for second spot.
Looked like Mark got a little bit loose getting into turn three, but he ain't going to give up.
And Martin comes back after him again.
White flag.
One to go. One lap remaining for Kevin LePage, and now his lead goes up over a second and a half, and it's side by side, back and forth for second place, down into turn two.
Those guys are going at it for that second place. Here comes Martin back on the inside. Kevin LePage is out there just riding, but this race for second is something else.
Kevin LePage has got him covered. Here's the battle. It's between two Winston Cup stars following this Grand National driver to the line. Kevin LePage is about to win his first Grand National victory. 65,000 fans on their feet in the greater Miami area, and LePage has done it. Battle for second place comes to the line. It's Bobby Labonte defeating Mark Martin at the stripe. Randy Lajoie comes across. He will be the Grand National Champion, the Busch Grand National Champion for 1996. Here he comes. What a great moment for Steve Byrd, another New England fellow that has worked on these cars for a couple of decades. And with Randy Lajoie, Bill Baumgartner wins the national championship. Second win for Gardner. Won it 2 years ago with Johnny Benson. And let's go to Ralph Shaheen.
All right, Ken, we're down here with the crew. They're celebrating with Steve Byrd. You guessed, Purdy, you guessed pretty good on the gas. How do you feel now?
Why do I feel good? I tell you, we didn't have much left. We were real worried. I don't know. I want to say hi to Myron Barr of Hope, and all the guys at Every Jazz Band will be partying tonight with you guys.
Congratulations on your second championship 2 years in a row. Now, don't make sure you don't run your car at home that low on fuel.
Hell no. You know what? I wish Johnny was around right now, because I'd like to see Johnny, too, you know. We're great friends, and I want to thank Feener and Marketing 500, Crick, Castle Springs Water. I mean, it's just tremendous. It's great, you know.
Did the push from Jimmy Spencer make the difference? As he comes over and gets congratulated from the crew, from David Green, did the push from Jimmy Spencer make the difference, Birdie?
Well, I don't know. Anything. We had to try anything. Maybe it helped, maybe it didn't. We'll see here. We put fuel in it.
You can tell he's very emotional today, Ken, of course. Randy Lajoie becoming the first driver to win both the Busch North and the Busch Championship.
By 29 points, Lajoie the champion with Steve Bird. And here is our winner of the race with his wife, Donna, in Victory Circle, a woman that was his car owner and crew chief and has stuck with him through the hard days to have this glorious day at Homestead.
Step on the roof, dude.
All right.
We are supposed to be the champion.
And he has already told his crew chief, C.R. Miller, he said, I'm going on the roof. Miller says, don't jump up and down. Don't wreck the car. His wife, Donna, has been here. She was the scorer from high atop the grandstand watching this whole thing go on. Kevin's calling his wife, Donna, into the picture now as well. He should. You came down to this series with your own car, ran out of money, almost out of it. Did you think this day would never come?
I knew it was coming when I hooked up with David and Karen Ridlin, C.R. Miller, and all the guys here. What a best way to debut a new sponsor with Hype. I'll tell you, everything was just perfect today. The pit stops were great. Just everything in the whole day was just perfect.
Donna, are those tears? What was your edge today? How'd this car get so fast?
Well, I'll tell you, we unloaded off the truck the other day. We did one spring rubber. That's all we did to the car. We never touched it.
What are you going to do tonight to celebrate?
Drink Hype.
Drink some Hype.
Well, they got the sponsor in. Okay, let's go to Ralph Shaheen with the champion. Ralph?
Well, Dick, you can see it right here. The paper's been printed already. Extra, extra. Randy Lajoie is the champion. He's joined down here by Mom and Dad Lajoie. Boy, first you had to deal with the wreck and then the gas problem. Tell me about the wreck first.
It looked like somebody got up a little too high, got in the wall, and bounced off the wall and hit us. But I tell you, that's the way our season's been going. This race team, we've been down all year. We keep fighting back, and these guys never gave up on me. I just had to pull these belts tight. They made a good call, stay out, because we're running competitive times. And that race car, I can't say enough about this base motorsports team. It's hard enough to win one championship, to come back and win two with two different drivers 2 years in a row. It's just awesome. I mean, it's been a great year for me, my family. It's wonderful.
Was there ever a point in the race between the gas and the crash that maybe you just thought this thing is over?
Well, then they said, we might be three or four laps short. I had a really good race car, but I had to look at the big picture. I knew what on top five wasn't gonna do any good if we run out of gas with two to go. So I just started conserving fuel, and when a 95 car went by, I mean, he had 33 points to make up, and one position wasn't gonna matter. And the good Lord was on our side all year long, and this is great.
First thing you did was you got the push from Jimmy Spencer. You also let out the gas a little bit earlier going into the turns. What else did you do to conserve fuel today?
Jimmy never come up and gave us a push. We asked him to, but I guess, he was running good enough where he didn't want to mess up the front of his car. And that's fine, but, it was in our cards that we had enough fuel. I'm not sure how much fuel was left, but, the good Lord's watching. I got to thank FINA, our associate sponsors, Castle Springs, K-Tech Engines. I mean, Base Motorsports, I mean, once again, this race team was just phenomenal all year long, and I'm just glad to be part of it.
You'd felt a little uneasy all week long. Now you're the first guy to ever win the Busch Championship and the Busch North Championship as well. Congratulations, Randy.
Thank you very much. I can't wait for that ring tomorrow night.
Ken?
There he is coming across the line. You saw his dad in the background. His dad had won some 300 races down at the old Danbury Racerama, and I don't think he ever celebrated a more happy moment than when his son has won this championship. And there's David Green walking away from this race. He gave it everything he had, came back from that terrible crash at Charlotte, came in here today, and he walks out with head high after giving us such a dramatic program. Coming up, the truck program. We've got that truck championship out there in Vegas. Hey, the
victory today by Kevin LePage moved him up to eighth in the final standings for the season. And there are some of the folks that play just down the road here at Homestead, Homestead Air Force Base. Pretty good ticket ride there. Let's go to Mike Joy, who is standing by in Las Vegas as we get ready for the second part of our doubleheader today.
Ken, we're just about 30 minutes away from the start of this race. The crowd is filing in and the drivers are being introduced. Pacing just a bit is Ron Hornaday, who carries a 72-point lead into this event. His truck is gridded well back in the field, back in 18th position. But Hornaday's won championships before, and so has the man he has in his corner, NASCAR's winningest active man in terms of championships. Talked earlier with Glenn Jarrett.
Dale Earnhardt has 7 national titles. He's here today to try to help his driver, Ron Hornaday, win his first. Dale, what do the guys have to do today?
Well, nothing's got to break for one. Everything's got to stay on the truck and running fine. Ron's to stay out of trouble. So I'm going to be up on the top talking to him and trying to keep him, you know, alert of what's going on around him. He's a great driver, and I'm sure he's going to do the job himself. But any help he can get is going to be good.
Dale, this is a brand new facility. It's a big field. It's a fast field. There's a lot of inexperienced drivers out there. Is that a concern?
Well, it is. And starting back in 18th, you got a lot of trucks around you that you're not sure of. But still, a lot of practice and a lot of time out here, so everybody looks pretty smooth on the track. I'm just glad he's not like 25th or worse. I'm like I qualify sometimes for these races. But, you know, I'm fairly comfortable. Richard Childerson, I've talked about it a lot. And, you know, he's given me a lot of confidence on how to approach it. We've got a backup truck here with Steve Park driving it for sort of a position holder. If we need to, you know, pull a position off, that'd be good. But right now we're going to run the trucks as is and try to run the race with both trucks.
But now Richard Childress will also be advising his driver, Mike Skinner, in this event. Buddy, if you're Ron Hornaday, how do you drive this race?
Well, very cautiously, and he has to learn in the first half what adjustments he needs to make to really run well at the end. So, right, I think the first little bit of the race, he needs to be very careful not to get caught up in a race of some kind and maybe put himself out.
Now, would you expect Skinner and Sprague to run just flat out?
Hey, they're going to go for it. There's nothing going to be left in their bank when it's all over.
Ken Squire?
Hey, that's going to be fun. Those Craftsman NASCAR trucks put on some great racing. This is going to be their fastest race here at Homestead. Here you see the winner, Randy Lajoie. there was a little spin down the victory, and Steve Bird. Take a look at this, McReynolds.
Well, I think they definitely had something to celebrate. And you know, I got to tip my hat and all but salute Steve Bird. What he had to go through mentally today. He watched his car get involved in an accident, had to deal with fixing it, got a lap down, made a great call leaving that car out, made that lap up. Then if that wasn't enough, had to deal with a fuel mileage issue. So Steve Bird deserves to celebrate tonight.
Lisa and Cora and Casey and the whole gang having quite a time down here, the LaJoys, celebrating their championship.